Live from Wildcat Stadium in Westerville, Ohio. It's a packed one tonight as Stanley Jackson brings his undefeated Westerville North Warriors to Westerville South to face Matthew Crist and the Westerville South Wildcats on the CBUS Sports Radio High School Football Friday Night Game of the Week. It's an OCC Capital battle tonight between the undefeated Westerville North Warriors and the 3-2 Westerville South Wildcats. I'm Mitchell Pallibagas alongside Chris Coffey. Tonight we've got a lot of interesting games tonight. I don't think any more interesting really than what we have. Got a couple of Central Catholic League games that catch. You got to turn your mic on there, House Bay.
That would help, wouldn't it?
Yeah, a couple of that. DeSales is hosting at St. Charles tonight, is it? And then Watterson and Hartley, but I'm not sure where that's at.
That's at ODU. I'm pretty sure that's at ODU. I think DeSales is hosting Hartley, or hosting St. Charles.
So we've got some Central Catholic League battles going on tonight. Tonight's an OCC Capital tilt. A surprising 5-0 Westerville North team under first-year head coach Stanley Jackson. His son, we saw him last week at North, what, about 6-7 minutes from here, with pending traffic, of course.
As
they come up with a win over a pretty good Delaware Hayes team.
Their first test of the year,
I think. Yeah, I think so. But they've got wins on the young season. They started out the season with a 21-12 win over a winless Westerville Central team. Then they beat Central Crossing 42-21, Chillicothe 42-0, at Franklin Heights a 49-7 win, and then last week a 14-7 win over Hayes to get themselves to 5-0. Since we saw South back in week three as they hosted Olin Angie.
Yep.
They lost that game 34-14, but they pick up a win over Sider, which you have to beat because they're not playing good football this year so far. 42-10, and going to Big Walnut to me to beat the Eagles 22-7. That's a good win. I don't care what their record says.
It's only
1-4, but going on the road, I think that's a good sign for the South Wildcats.
Well, and you go up there and you look at that. Yeah, Big Walnut's 1-4. They've got three Division I recruits that are big guys. Two guys going to Ohio State, I believe. But, you know, in that game, when we were here on September 1st, when Olin Kanji came in, when the Cats hosted the Braves, Westerville South could just not get any offense. Generally, that 14 points, folks, was scored in, the last six minutes of the game. And they did a pretty good job of containing the high-power Brave offense, come in averaging over 42 points. I mean, they scored 31, but still, I mean, it keeps them below their average. It's going to be an interesting matchup. I think this will still, last week I thought was going to be the biggest tough test for Westerville North against Hayes. It's even going to be bigger tonight.
This is the first of three very, very, very big games for the South Wildcats. They've got the undefeated North Warriors tonight. They host Hayes next week, who's 4-1 going into their action tonight. And then they go at Canal, who's 5-0 right now. So you're looking at a situation where they've got to make hay in these next three games.
Yeah, without a doubt. You're looking at the OCC Capital standings right there. Three teams undefeated in the conference at this point, both Canal Winchester and Westerville North at 5-0, 2-0 in conference play. South comes in at 3-2, 2-0, followed by Delaware Hayes 4-1, 1-1, Scioto 1-4, 1-1, Big Walnut 1-4, as mentioned, 0-2, Franklin Heights with a win, 1-4, and 0-2, and the Kilborn Wolves struggling mightily this year, 0-5, 0-2 on the season in the OCC Capital.
For the Warriors, Chris, they're in the middle of that three-team struggle, as you might call
it. Yes, yes.
Last week they defeated Delaware, this week at South, and next Friday night in a good ball game up at North, they're going to host Canal.
Right.
And then they finish up their final three games of the year. They'll have a trip to Big Walnut, then they finish up with Kilborn at home, which they should beat Kilborn inside, I would think, in a rather handily fashion. But as the proverbial saying goes, that is why you play the ball game.
That is exactly right, my friend.
And I forgot to mention Westerville South, after they get through that three-game stretch, they finish after playing Hayes and at Canal. Then they're in Franklin Heights at home and finish up the season at Kilborn.
Two games they should win.
They really should. If they can get two of these, it would really help. I forgot to mention Westerville South is currently ranked number 9 in Division II, Region number 7.
Right.
Where it is Westerville North. They are rated number 5 in Division I, Region 3. So if South, it would be massive
Division
win
one
for
points.
South.
Yeah. Division 1 points, big time.
No question about that. That'd be a big win for them tonight. Let's take a look at some of the other games, Chris. I didn't take a deep dive in the schedule just yet, but I saw those games that caught my eye, no question, was the DeSales and Watterson ball games. Just as a note, Hayes is hosting Worthington Kilborn. You would expect Hayes to come away with the win there tonight. Let's see. Hartley and Watterson, I mentioned that game. That is at ODU, as you noted. St. Francis de Sales is at St. Charles.
Oh, it is at St. Charles.
It
okay.
is indeed.
Let me see if I can bring this graphic up for us here, Bud, so our viewers can see what we're talking about here.
Oh, okay. Where are you at in that schedule?
I'm clear at the top. I'm up at Dublin, Jerome, going over to Thomas Worthington.
Okay, Dublin, Jerome, and Thomas Worthington playing tonight. Canal is at Dublin Cider. That should be a win. Darby in Marysville, Kilbourne in Hayes. We mentioned that. Mifflin and Centennial, Urbana and Jonathan Alder. 4-1, the Pioneers are.
Yeah.
Grandview and West Bend was Worthington Christian, Pandora, Gilboa. Pandora, excuse me. Bishop Harley and Watterson, we mentioned that. St. Francis de Sales and St. Charles. Linda McKinley at Beechcroft, Afrocentric at West, Kip at Bishop Reedy, Franklin Heights at Big Walnut.
Reedy with a big win last week at the Sales.
Indeed, a very, very big one. North and Westerville South, that's our ball game here on The Bus. Ted's Classic Cuts pregame show. Briggs at Eastmore, Fairbanks at Triad, Mechanicsburg at West Jeff, Westerville Central. Not going to get a win tonight at Pick North unless something very, 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 very unusual happens.
And but they are playing better. They took Kaufman to a
rope.
Last
yeah.
minute, the field goal at time expired to win last week for Dublin Kaufman.
Central Crossing at Lancaster South at Independence, Buckeye Valley at Bexley, Whitehall at Academy, New Albany at Grove City, the Scots at Marion Franklin, Grove City Christian at Miller, Hamilton at Amanda, London at Bell Fountain. I think we're about ready to have the national anthem.
Yeah, I believe so.
We're going to turn over the Westerville South marching band as they play the national anthem.
As we proudly join in the playing of our national anthem.
Westerville South marching band with the Star Spangled Banners. Get the festivities closer to kickoff.
You want to go to the starting lineups?
Whatever order you want to do, I'm willing to do.
It's up to you. I'll just put them on the screen. You read them all.
All right. We do know that Westerville South won the toss, and they deferred their choice to the second half. Let's take a look at the starting offense for the undefeated Westerville North Warriors, a first-year head coach, Stanley Jackson, former Buckeye. Got to change it right tackle. Christian Ayers Strickland is not playing in the game tonight. I've got his, well, what I saw in warm-ups, hard to tell for sure, but I've got Denylan Taylor, a 6'5", 243-pound sophomore, lining up at right tackle in pregame.
And that's a low, because that young man's 6'5", 306 pounds.
Indeed. Left tackle is Jay Cook, a junior, 6'5", 285.
Who's getting looks from Louisville.
Right guard is Victor Schutz, a senior, 6'1", 280. Left guard is Skyler Johnson, 6'3", 266. The center is Jay Kirsch, a 6'2", sophomore, 307-pounder.
Big, bad Brian Robinson.
Senior tight end and very good defensive end, 6'5", 255, and a senior. Barry Adams, a 6'4", 194 wide receiver, very good ball player. Marion Walker, wide receiver, 5'10", 163, sophomore. Our senior, rather, Will Solomon, 5'8", 135 pounds. Jonathan Stevens is a 6'1", 178 junior running back. We'll also see Lem Reynolds, 6'1", 191 senior. Quarterback, Ronald Jackson, junior, 5'11", 160. Defensively for Westerville South. The DN is London Vicroy, 6'4", 195, and a sophomore. Anchor, Zay Furman, 6'1", 230, senior. Nose tackle, Bo Baker, 5'9", 240. Chris, that's to me where this that game's got to be won. When
Without
you look at the offensive line for the Warriors, 243, 280, 307, 266, 285, for the South Wildcats, 195-242-30.
And you throw in a 255-pound, 6'5" tight end in that blocking scheme as well.
The linebackers for South will have to be play very big tonight. The Leos, Ian Smith, 5'9", 155 junior. The same as Dylan Shoemaker, 5'10", 175 and a junior. Preston Kawas, the Mike, 6'2", 15 junior. The Willis, Neo Thomas, junior, 5'9", 190. Cornerbacks, Antonio Armistead, senior, 6'1", 175. The other cornerback is Cam Garcia, 5'10", 165 and a senior. The safety is Isaac Patterson, 6'1", 175 and a sophomore, and Jordan Wheeler, a good ball player.
Yes.
6'1", 175, Jordan is a senior. Offensively for Westerville South, when they have the ball tonight, Tyler Heilbrun will be the right tackle, 6'2", 220 and a senior. Left tackle, Zach Moose, 6'2", 205 and a junior. Manny Soiree, a senior, 6'2", 30. Left guard is R.J. Deersing. Even got that pronunciation from the PA announcer, 5'10", 205 and a sophomore. And Xavier Flemister is the center, 5'10", 235 and a junior. Apparently, Chris, they've discovered X-back Tyler Kilmeyer, 6'7", 230. He's kind of been introduced in the lineup. Tyler's a junior. He didn't get enough passes, we thought, in that Olentangy game.
I don't believe so.
The A-back is Jordan Wheeler, 6'1", 175 senior. B-back is Isaac Patterson, a sophomore, 6'1", 175. Dre McDuffie, Y-back, 6'3", 180 and a senior. The H-back is Brady Krill, 5'11", 205 senior. Very good running back in Nasir Phillips, 5'8", 185. The man stirring the drink tonight, Dom Bertha, the straw stirring the drink. Senior, 5'11", 185.
They've got to get Nasir. They've got to get him the ground game going tonight, in my opinion, to kind of control the clock a little bit on this offense, because they've got to keep it out of the hands of Westerville North's big bruising running game. Ronald Jackson did a pretty good job of throwing the ball last week. And we kind of watched him on some film. He was kind of missing some passes in some film we saw. He threw some great passes last week, which just flat out dropped, Mitch. So I think they're going to try to run the ball. He is dangerous on that read option.
The defensive ends for the Westerville North Warriors are very, very good football players. Deion Brian Robinson, I called him big and bad because he really impressed us last week. Senior, 6'5", 255. On the other side, Braylon Nolan, very good player as well. 6 foot, 200-pound senior. Got a good speed rush. Jake Cook is a nose tackle, 6'5", 285 and a junior. We do not know who's taking the place of Janarius Strickland at the D-tackle's position. We'll kind of watch that for you. The Will linebackers, Austin Baker, 6 foot, 185 senior. 188, rather. The star is Trey McDonald, junior, 5'9", 163. The Mac is 6 foot, 191-pound senior, Lem Reynolds. Cornerback, senior, Will Solomon, 5'8", 135. And Quinn Ingram, 6 foot, 165 and a junior. Safeties are Quinn Barry Wilson, 6'2", 175. And senior, I'm sorry, junior safety, Johnson Stevens.
What? I mistyped. That's Owen.
Owen?
Yeah. I fat-fingered. Owen. It's not a Q, it's an O. My bad.
Owen.
I'll take the hit on that.
Okay. Mrs. Barry, Chris Coakley, CBUSSportsRadio.com. Chris, a couple things that we saw last week. Watching North, and haven't seen South in 3 weeks now, being the second to last. It's actually the fourth Friday in September, and then we got one more next week before we march into October. If you can't block these defensive ends, Robinson and Nolan, you're not passing the ball effectively.
Well, and what I found out this week, Mr. Robinson's playing in the All-American game later in the year, folks. So that's telling you something right there. That young man is 6'5", 255 pounds. He is a senior. We watched him last week, and he just dominated the defensive front on the outside edge against Delaware Hayes last week.
Now, Braylon Nolan also a bit more of a speed rusher, but Brian Robinson is a powerful young man again, 6'5", 255. So Don Bertha, to me, I thought he tried to do a little bit too much on his own. In our first broadcast we had against Olentangy, use the weapons you have around you. I was talking to the PA announcer. He thought that Kilmeyer being introduced in the offense has really helped kind of settle them down a bit. But at 6'7", 230, and as a junior, he's going to match up good with Will Salma at 5'8", and Quinn Ingram at 6 foot. He's got almost a foot on Mr. Solomon. Take advantage of that matchup if you can at all. Offensively for Westerville North, as Chris mentioned, I would expect to see the featured running game of Ronald Jackson running the read option with Jonathan Stevens and Lem Ingrams. If they cannot, as Westerville North comes out on the field, they've got white unis on tonight with their USC-style helmets. Boy, they've got yellow numerals, Chris, so it's going to be really tough to pick out tonight. They're outlined in that deep red. We'll keep an eye on them tonight. By the way, Chris, you text me, midday today and say, no tickets being sold.
Yeah.
Nobody's getting here. It is a packed house. standing room only here tonight at Westerville South Wildcat Stadium. And if the defensive for Westerville South, if they can't slow down Stanley Jackson in the running game, they're going to have a very difficult time winning this game tonight.
It's going to be very difficult. I'm looking forward to it. As mentioned, probably the best test for both these teams so far this year, and it should be a good one here. We appreciate the athletic department from both teams, both coaching staffs for getting us the information, getting ready to get this one underway here on CBUS Sports Radio.
Winds tonight out of the east-northeast at 4 miles an hour. Winds gusting up to 8, so basically Old Glory in the eastern end zone, laying pretty low right now. Not much wind at the moment. 74 degrees, a real 472. Otherwise, it's an absolute perfect night for high school football on the bus.
I want to go over the coaching staff just one more
time.
We did not go able to go over that. First-year head coach Stanley Jackson, 5-0 career. Stanley's doing a good job. As mentioned, they are a Division I Region 3 participant. And I think, like you said, they are in the 5 spot right behind Gahanna Lincoln. Matthew Crisp will be coaching Westerville South. He is in his 7th season, 3-2 on the year. They are Division II, Region 7. He is 41-26 overall.
The Wildcats are out on the field. They've got black trousers on, red jerseys, black numerals outlined in white, and the red helmets with the cats on the side. Now, give me a college. We can see the USC in north. What about south here?
Well, if Georgia wore black pants and red shirts, it would be Georgia in my estimation.
Well, thank you for listening to us tonight. A lot of people here, but thank goodness not a lot of media here, if that makes sense.
I thought the press box would be packed tonight. Go ahead. I'm going to ask the coaching staff if they want me to close this door so they don't hear us.
Okay, no problem at all. I would say they probably want it closed. I mean, I'd want to hear me, but I'm not sure they want to hear us. Again, Westerville South won the toss. They deferred to the second half, so they'll be kicking off in about 2.5 minutes to the Westerville North Warriors, who will have the ball tonight for the first time offensively. Big offensive line against the Westerville South Wildcats. That will be the matchup advantage for Westerville North.
Wow. There goes my cameras again with the bombs.
Oh. Up at Westerville North last week, they kept spewing baby powder into the atmosphere.
And I've still got on my cameras.
It was quite amazing when we were packing up and walking out last Friday how much dust was actually in the cameras.
If you're listening to our audio broadcast, you want to flip over and watch us on Twitch or on our YouTube channel, please feel free to do that. You can also go directly to our webpage, CBUSSportsRadio.com. CBUSSportsRadio.com. You can either listen to the radio broadcast there or watch our stream. Also, we want to give a shout-out to our friends over at CBUS Local. They are broadcasting tonight the Grandview Heights game over during the stream tonight as well. Mitchell.
Next Friday night?
Yeah. Let's do you know how I am with my graphics, my friend.
Not a problem. Let me know when you're ready.
There you go.
Next Friday night, I'm going to be probably out of town. That is the plan right now. So Chris is going to be over at Hilliard Darby as Olin Tangi Berlin will be coming calling. Then 2 weeks from tonight, we're going to be over at Harvest Prep, Chris, down in Canal. That should be quite a ball game as Harvest Prep, the Warriors, going to welcome in the Irish of St. Vincent, St. Mary. We don't mind going to Harvest Prep, but generally if we're going to prep, that means one thing, Chris, what?
We're on the roof, and hopefully it doesn't rain.
Yeah, normally when we get down to prep, we are definitely on the roof. So let's just hope we have good weather down there at Harvest Prep 2 weeks from Friday night. Where are we at for the final couple ball games of the year, sir?
We are scheduled. Grove City in week 9. We'll have Gahanna Lincoln down at Grove City. Then we are still trying to get confirmation about doing that week 10 matchup. That's going to be a big one in the OCC Ohio and in the region. Really, that's probably going to determine the region winner or who number one seed in the region between Pick North at Gahanna Lincoln. So we'll let you our backup game for that. We're thinking about Granville over at Watkins if we cannot get that Gahanna Lincoln game.
And that really is, that's kind of out of our control. If too many people want to be there, we're not going to be there. So we'll just hope that we can do that ball game. But starting the second half of the season tonight from Wildcat Stadium, just about ready to get underway. Teeing it up tonight for the Westerville South Wildcats is Junior Adarqua. It's actually Junior Adarqua, excuse me. I don't want to butcher it too bad.
Wildcats number 83, Jonathan Adarqua. Back deep for Westerville North.
Left-footed kicker. You don't see that too much in high school football.
Jonathan Stevens back deep.
Number 3, Jonathan Stevens. Number 4, Will Solomon.
Okay, Solomon Stevens back. Ball just slightly off-centered as Again, it's a packed house tonight. Here's the kick. It's coming down the near side hash. That will be fielded by Stevens around the 10-yard line. He's going to work through the middle of the field. Got an opening at the 20-yard line. 25, tackled at the 30-yard line. That was a really good tackle there, Chris. I thought that was maybe number two, Cameron Garcia made that.
I think
tackle.
Cam Garcia on special teams getting down there and making a stop. They set up that wall perfect. There was a monster block on one of the seals there that just knocked that young man right out of his shoes.
First play from scrimmage coming up for Ronald Jackson, the Westerville North Warriors. Again, ginormous offensive line. Just a big group of young men. South a little bit undersized on the defensive front. Linebackers are going to have to come up big, Chris. Three down defensive linemen, four linebackers. Two wideouts and two backs in the backfield with junior quarterback and captain Ronald Jackson.
He's electric. He's got a lot of athletic ability.
Long look over to the sideline. Backs on each side of Jackson in the shotgun. Has a snap. Hands it off.
Nice play.
In the backfield and taken down immediately. I think that might have been Lem Reynolds. Let's check. It was Lem Reynolds on the carry.
Zay Furman on the stop.
Loss of two on the play to make it second and 12.
Boy, he's been a stellar. We've been coming out to Westerville South for a number of years. And that young man has played a lot of good football here for Coach Matthew Cruz.
He's the anchor defensive end, near side, as we look at it, towards the press box. We've got the future Wildcat cheerleaders out there, Chris. It's a cheerleader palooza down there.
Youth night tonight. Law enforcement in full force tonight here. A lot of deputy sheriffs as well as Westerville PD.
Ronald Jackson to keep on the quarterback read option. Crosses the 30 out to the 35-yard line, maybe the 36.
Isaac Patterson on the stop for the catch.
Stevens was running the option with him.
7-yard gain.
Let's call it third and what, Chris, about four? Maybe five? Jackson sends wides each way. Stevens is going to be a slot left side with Reynolds in the backfield with him. Everybody checking the dreaded wristbands. Ronald steps back into the gun. Reynolds to his right. He'll run the read option to the right. Jackson with a pitch to Reynolds at the 35, at the 40, down the far sideline, midfield. 40, at the 30. Can anybody catch him? 20, 10, tripped up at the 5, but stumbles into the end zone for the touchdown. That'll be a 64-yard touchdown run from Len Reynolds on a perfectly executed read option. The 6-foot, 191-pound senior running back got down that far sideline. Good tackle attempt about the 5. Oh, my God.
Out of bounds, yeah.
I did not see that.
Apologize, folks. The camera's decided to stall out on us again.
So it's going to be first and goal at the 9. I thought he made it in, Chris, but apparently he got knocked out at the 9-yard line. Ball's on the right hash for Ronald Jackson. That was poorly contained by the South Wildcat defense.
Corner did not get in the correct position.
So again, it'll be Reynolds and check that. Stevens in the backfield, but somebody else for Reynolds. Here's a handoff to Stevens, hit in the backfield, and it'll be pulled down right away.
Number 3, Jonathan Stevens on the
getting in there to bring him down was Preston Kawa and others.
Tackled by number 25, Preston Kawa.
That'll be a loss of a couple on the play. It isn't taking me long to diagnose, Chris, as we're just underway. The dive doesn't look like it's going to work, but the read option definitely looks like it's going to work. Stevens out. Or he's actually going to become a slot on the right side. If they're going to spread everybody out, Chris, I would be definitely full-out alert for a quarterback draw here from Ronald Jackson. Three wide split out wide to the right. Jackson back to pass. Throws right side. It's a bubble screen. Stevens has it at the 10. Hit it to 5. Able to churn down inside the 5 to about the 3, I think. We'll check that spot. The only thing I have a real problem with in football at any level is when the receivers can go down and block before the pass is thrown, 6 yards down the field. I have an issue with that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry I don't like the rule. I mean, North is taking advantage of it, but they've got a 3rd and goal now from the 4-yard line, they'll say. Jackson with Stevens to his right, wides each way. Hand off to Stevens, hit at the goal line. I think he's going to be just short, Chris.
Yeah, Furman on the stop. I believe it was Jordan Wheeler coming up from his safety position to put the final hit on him, just short of the goal line.
And by just short, we are seriously talking about 6 inches. 4th and goal, 8:56 remaining in the quarter. Got to imagine that North will go for this. Stevens and Jackson in the backfield. Bunch of big bodies up there. In fact, Chris is going to take the left tackle and bring him to the right. Jake Cook on the right side of the line of scrimmage. Ronald Jackson's going to keep it himself. Makes a nice move at the 2-yard line and scampers into the end zone for six. Takes a bow.
For a Westerville North touchdown.
Bowing to the band at the 8:35 mark. Makes it 6-0 for the guests. At the, again, 8:35 mark. Set up by a big run from Lem Reynolds. There's a defender in the hole to try to make a tackle attempt on Ronald Jackson, and he absolutely L. Wiffenstein. Josh Link going to attempt the PAT. Snaps a little bit wobbly. The kick, or the hold's down. The kick is going to be. Boy, he got it through there. That
the extra point is
snap
good.
Was barely down. 8:35 left in the first quarter. We'll take a timeout. North lead, 7-0, CBUS Sports Radio
Westfield
Network.
Game. This is Paul Keels, and you know how much I love broadcasting the Buckeyes, but I also love high school sports. On behalf of the OHSAA, let's all do our part to set a good example and make this a fun and safe experience for the kids involved. I know this game means so much to the players, coaches, and fans, but high school sports are about much more than the wins and losses. They teach life lessons that will be with the players long after their playing days are over. Good luck to both teams, and remember to respect the game.
Back on the CBUS Sports Radio Network, Mitch Pybakus alongside Chris Coakley just underway. Opening drive for Westerville North. They take it 80 yards for the touchdown.
Taking off for Westerville North, number 17.
Ronald Jackson with the one-yard TD run.
Back deep for the Wildcats, number 22, Ian Gordon.
Link on to kickoff now. He's got it centered up almost. Approaches the ball, puts the boot into it. It's down the near sideline. That's going to hit and go out of bounds. And that is no good. No bueno. Giving a team excellent field position by not able to keep it in the field of play.
Penalty on the play. Kickoff out of bounds.
Well, it looks like the cameras don't want to cooperate, Mitch. They were starting up, so we're going to have to be going back and forth. So I might be kind of silent here for a while.
That's not a problem. My internet's not working real well here either. Just trying to use my phone as a hotspot's gotten to be a problem here. Trying to reset that so we can keep you posted on.
A lot of people pinging the tower tonight here.
Yes, quite a few people packed in. Should not be an issue, frankly, but apparently it is. First and 10 for Dom Bertha and the Westerville South Wildcat offense. Three wides left, one wide right. Dom Bertha. Hands off to Nasir Phillips, hit the line of scrimmage, and maybe makes it out to the 37-yard line. Braylon Nolan, rather than others, combined to stop him after a one-yard gain.
Brought down by number 33, Kai Stovall. Gain of two on the play.
Second and eight, they'll call it. Here's a swing pass to Nasir Phillips on the left side. He's got room at the 40, at the 45, out the midfield stretch. Bounces out of a tackle and takes all the way down to the north 41-yard line. That's pretty good strength out of Zier Phillips right there, Chris.
Yeah, he's a good running back, folks. He's been around for a couple years as well. They're going quick offense here.
They will indeed. Twins each way for Don Bertha. And we've got a defensive end offside. Where's the flag? Boy, that was really late. Jumping off line offside was Brian Robinson.
Encroachment against Westerville North.
That's a good hard count from Don Bertha. Forgot to mention that the Goshen Warriors are at my New Richmond Lions tonight, and Chris's Golden Lions are hosting the dreaded Westland Cougars. Game time temp again was 74 beautiful degrees. It's just had a couple great weather weekends here on the bus. Twins again each way for Don Bertha.
Press coverage up on the outside on Kielmeyer.
Good luck with that one. First and five from the 36-yard line of North. Bertha checking things out, has a snap, fakes a handoff, keeps it himself around the left side, has the first down to 30, at the 25, pulled down around the 23, and they're going to mark it right at the 23-yard line.
Good run there by Dom. Is he able to pull it back out, keep it?
Forgot to mention, Chris, a pretty big matchup in Hilliard tonight as Bradley travels over to Davidson. What's that about? A
It's about 3 miles.
Well, half a mile is a crow fly, yeah. But to get around there, you're right. First and 10 at the 23. Bertha back to pass. Throws right flat, and it's dropped. Isaac Patterson couldn't reach down to make that catch.
Just a bit low, Mitch. Just a bit low.
A little bit late that if someone was there, a defender, if he'd have picked it, it'd have been an easy pick six. Second and 10, 23-yard line of Westerville North. Berth with a handoff to Nasir Phillips. Nowhere to go there. Maybe a yard. Chris, we saw this in the Olin Tangi game. They were able to do pretty well getting down towards the 20-yard line, but they kind of stalled in that red zone area.
Yeah, exactly.
Not in the red zone yet. But
they didn't do bad, like you said, moving between the 20s, but when it got in there, you've got a stoppage in play as Mr. Wheeler tripped over the ball. He's going to get set.
We're going to have McDuffie split wide right with Patterson, and Wheeler and Kilmeyer split wide left. Back to pass is Bertha. Pressure coming, throws over the head of Kilmeyer. Incomplete.
Pass incomplete intended for number 18, Tyler Kilmeyer.
So fourth down, right?
Yep, I think they're going to go for it, Chris.
Fourth down and 9.
I think they just don't have the leg from the field goal kicker that they've had in the past here. Ethan Rosen does the place kicking.
A little bit of a mix-up, I think. Kilmeyer wasn't in the same spot the pass went to. Twins each way, and going to have actually trips right and twins left. Nasir Phillips slot on the left side. Kind of a faux snap there by Don Bertha, and now he gets the play from the sideline. Awaits a snap, he has it. Rush coming, gets a screen to Phillips at the 20-yard line at the 15. Cuts to a tackle, dives inside the 10-yard line, and they'll have a first and goal at the 10. Good great move by Phillips.
Not only a good move by Nasir Phillips, a great call by the coaching staff there.
No doubt about it. What's the over-under on your Lions score tonight?
77. I don't think Coach Ward will run it up. I mean, like you said, you play him for a reason. It should not be a close contest.
Correct. Trips right, one wide left. Kilmeyer all by himself. That's a short side of the field. Back to pass is Chris. He's going to throw into the end zone for Patterson. He drops the ball. That was in Isaac Patterson's hands. He's got to make that catch, Chris. 6:28 mark.
Don Bertha puts that right on the money, folks.
Penalty on the play.
We got a hold. Looks like it's against Westerville South, Mitchell.
So it wouldn't have mattered in the
final scheme of things, right?
Yes.
Holding against the Wildcats.
Back to the 20-yard line.
He put that right on the money,
and
didn't
it was
he?
A really nice pass.
Ball spotted on the 20-yard line.
So now Don Bertha and the Wildcat offense have a first and goal from the 20, less than ideal. Almost halfway through the first quarter. 7-0 is the score. North up. Same formation with trips right, one wide left. And off to Nasir Phillips, breaks a tackle at the line of scrimmage. Trying to get outside, it does! At the 15, at the 10, at the 5. He leaps into the end zone for the touchdown from 20 yards out. I was looking for flags, Chris. I thought it might have been a little bit of hold on the right side where Nasir Phillips cut, but no flag on the play, and he just leapt into the end zone, 20 yards.
20-yard run.
At the 6:20 mark of Q1. Looking for a holder or a long snapper or something.
So he did a good job. He broke three tackles to get into that position, Mitchell.
Ethan Rosen on the attempt to PAT. Westerville South really does have quite a solid history of very good tailbacks.
Oh, yeah. I mean, back when we started with Mike Mansouray, you remember that name?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
I think he went to South Dakota State. Does that sound right? The Jackrabbits?
The dreaded Jackrabbits.
Boy, those baby powder bombs.
Rosen going to attempt the PAT. Snap and hold are good. And the kick looks to be right down the middle. And it is. We're tied at 7 apiece. 6:20 left. First quarter. Back in a minute. CBUS Sports Radio Network.
What if you could go behind the scenes with athletes and coaches? Join Ken Carpenter, a veteran high school baseball coach, weekly as he examines success, failures, and life lessons in sports. Each episode provides valuable insight and understanding of playing or coaching team sports. Check out and follow his Athlete One podcast at athleteone.net. Great insight for coaches, parents, and student athletes.
Thank you for tuning in.
Back at Westerville South, I was wondering where you're going to get the mic to me there, young man. Sal, you have to turn your own mic on there.
Yeah, I know. This is night's messing me up here.
Kicking off tonight is, I didn't even hear him on the roster. I was trying to get, just to get his name.
A junior Arquaw.
Arquaw. He kicks near side, and he promptly boots it out of bounds. Great starting field position for an offense that doesn't need it. 35-yard line, Ronald Jackson and crew. That was a heck of a fourth down call, by the way, to Nasir Phillips. He made a great cut, around the 15?
Yeah, and made a guy miss, kind of went through an arm tackle. So we can put the ball here on the near hash, Mitch.
Indeed. We'll keep you up to date on scores around the area as they start to trickle in tonight. Marysville up on, I thought Darby was in. Is it Bradley at Davidson tonight?
Bradley's at Davidson.
Sorry, Bradley. Darby's down to Marysville 7-0 early. When Marysville got punked by Grove City last week.
Yes, they did.
Surprising score. Lem Reynolds, the lone deep back in the pistol behind Ronald Jackson. Two wides right. We've got a whistle and a timeout. Looks like an equipment issue is going to be pointed out. And Jake Cook's going to have to take a play off. Something with the knee pad, Chris?
Official's timeout.
It looked like he was pointing down to his shoes. So they're going to bring Brian Robinson in the tight end. He looks like he's going to step into that tackle position.
That appears to be it's not only his size, he's got extremely long arms. First and 10 from the 35. Stevens motions off that left slot. Going to run the option right side. Jackson pitches to Stevens. He's got the corner at the 40. At the 45, where he's upended. As he vaults across the 45 out to the 47.
Cam Garcia looked like come up from that cornerback position. That wide side was able to make the stop, Mitch.
I tell you, again, I'm not a prognosticator or some football savant. That read option, they have not been able to get to the edge.
The dive, they've diagnosed very well so far tonight.
Boy, Stevens flying through the air with the greatest of ease. Hit that turf hard. Lem Reynolds, a lone setback now in the pistol behind Jackson. And we've got a whistle and
a timeout, I think. Referee is saying like he was trying to. It's like he was pulling a flag out, but he wasn't throwing anything. He's got to come off the field.
Why they take? They're sending Stevens off the field. Do you know why they did that?
I have no idea. Has to be an equipment issue.
Did his helmet come off during that last play?
No. Not that I saw, Mitch.
I didn't either. If it did come off, he would have to take a playoff. 5:54 left first quarter. 7-7 your score on the CBUS Sports Radio Network. First and 10 from the 46 of the Warriors. Giving up that 15 yards on an out-of-bounds kick is really...
Not good.
Not good for either team. And now Ronald Jackson looks over his dad and says, all right, we're taking a TO. We'll keep it right here. To remind you again, next Friday night, you're going to be where?
Over at Darby as they welcome in the Bears of Berlin High School. I had to think about it for a second. I was kind of contemplating. You know, you and I talked about this last week. Very good ball game right back here next week as Delaware Hayes comes in. So we are scheduled to do the game over at Darby versus Berlin. We haven't had Berlin in football, so that'd be a good matchup to have.
Watterson 7. Hartley zip. Watterson
have good football. They might even be better this year than they were last year.
And they were good last year.
Look who they lost.
I know. They lost a lot of players.
Cole Rhett. Ryan Rosinski.
His son, silly.
So A.J. McInnish, the quarterback over there. Dom Purcell going to the Naval Academy. Very good football player. They've got a good club.
Indeed.
Coach Brian Kennedy's got them going.
Pick Center up 7-0 over Newark early. Warriors finally break the huddle.
And that allowed Cook to come back in on the timeout.
Lem Reynolds again will be the deep back. Actually, he's going to step just to the left of Ronald Jackson. Now he gets behind him in the pistol. Two wing backs, man in motion. Hand off to Reynolds. Tripped up the line of scrimmage, able to lunge forward for, actually, they're going to say right at the line of scrimmage.
maybe half a yard. Trying to see who made the stop. I believe it was Neo Thomas from that Will linebacker position. So they did put it right back in the line of scrimmage, Mitchell.
Yeah, they didn't give him anything. I'm more comfortable standing up, I got to tell you. I can only sit down so long on these tables that are designed for smaller people. Warriors going much slower pace than the South Wildcats.
Yes.
Second and 10 at the 46. Everybody checking their wristband as Jackson settles back into the pistol. Back behind him, back to his right. Actually, back to his left. Snap is to his right. It's well behind him at the 30-yard line. Stevens picks it up, trying to get out of trouble, and he'll be pulled down all the way back at the 25.
Neo Thomas on the stop, so Ayers compounding the field position here.
Jake Hirsch, that was well to the right of Ronald Jackson. He had no chance on that.
Number 27, Neo Thomas.
So Neo Thomas with the stop. That'll be a third and 27.
Spots the ball at the 26-yard line.
The scoreboard has a third and 30. Not that it's quite that much. Let me put it to you this way. It's third and a whole doggone bunch. They've got to get all the way down to the South 44 that their own 26. Ronald Jackson back to pass. Three-man rush, pressure coming. Rolling to the right, it's going to even long down the sideline. The catch is made by Stevens in midfield, and he's going to pick up the first down. He may score 30, 20, 10, and he's down back at the, or down about the three-yard line. Oh, we've got a flag all the way back at the 15-yard line. To bring that back, how do you leave somebody that wide open down the far sideline?
Well, it doesn't matter at this point, I guess.
Boy, what a break for Sal. Holding penalty, a flag down at the 15-yard line. And I tell you, he's a little bit exercised, Chris, is big Jake Cook, left tackle.
Yep, he is talking to the side judge there, it looks like. So they might have called him for a hold, Mitchell.
Stanley Jackson is not happy about this development, as you can well imagine. We'll see whether they will mark it. It's going to be at the 16, so third and even more. That's 30 plus 4 is 34 plus 6 is 40. Third and 40. Third and 40. Four wide set for Ronald Jackson. Three left, one right. Now I believe Reynolds is going to come in late and settle in the right slot. Five wides on the field. Watch the QB draw here.
Yeah, no doubt. Let's play it safe.
Jackson with the snap. Going to set the screen left side. It's caught at the 15. Hit at the 20 and taken down right there. See, he made that reception. Tyler Goble, I believe it was that.
I believe that's who it was. Number 10 for the Warriors. Tyler Goble.
Goble. So, boy, I tell you, a couple mistakes really cost Westerville North. And a bad snap and a penalty. Wiping out a massive gain. Link set the punt. Looks like it's one of the Wheelers back to receive, Chris. Is
Jordan.
That Jordan?
Yeah.
He's standing back around his own 42.
Number 6, Jordan Wheeler.
Link got three men up in front of him.
North, number 17, John Link.
I've got those Josh Links, but there's a kick. It's a short kick. Fair catch called for and made and bobbled by Wheeler, but he's able to grab it.
But good field position right here. So they flipped the field on him due to the bad snap.
And that is actually John Link.
Boy, I'm messing things up right and left, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Ball be spotted at the 47-yard line.
So first and 10 for the Wildcats. Great field position. Actually, just short, the tip of the ball is of the 47. Mitchell Pye, Vegas, Chris Coakley, 2:46 left in the first quarter. Tap at 7 apiece on the CBUS Sports Radio Network.
Appreciate you tuning in tonight.
Beautiful Friday evening on.
Good ball game. Good ball
indeed.
Game.
And we anticipated that. To say that, I mean, you look around here, Chris, this place really is quite packed.
Yeah.
Quite packed. Berth with two wides to his right, one wide to the left. Nasir Phillips in the backfield with him. And off to Phillips, breaks the tackle of the line of scrimmage, crosses the midfield stripe, and takes it down to about the 46.
This is the difference in this game than we saw on September 1st. They're establishing the running game with Nasir tonight.
Austin Baker tried to tackle him in the back, but he ran right through that tackle. Phillips must have trickled out of no, there. To, they have this thing where that clock sometimes will take 2 seconds before it actually counts, and it really is disturbing. Pioneers up three, by the way, over at Davidson. Is it the Bradley Pioneers?
Jaguars.
Bradley Jaguars. He said Pioneers. That's not true. But I'll have to get on my buddy Boggsy about that. Hand off to Nasir Phillips again, right side. Forced out of bounds around the 42. Should be enough for the first down. We'll confirm that spot. It is. Marked him out of bounds at the 41.
And number 8, Austin Baker. Ball's marked at the 41-yard line. First
two wides left, one wide right again.
Steady goes of Nasir Phillips here, Mitch.
The running game's a soul sapper.
Yep.
2:03 left in the first. Again, tied up at 7 apiece. Opening drive touchdown from north and an opening drive touchdown from south. And off left side to Phillips. He's thrown down in the backfield by Brian Robinson. He was in there immediately.
6'5 versus 5'9.
6'5'1, just in case you're curious. Second and 10. Kilmeyer and Wheeler split wide left. Patterson wide right. Dom Bertha barking out the call. Phillips just to his right in the gun. Back to pass is Bertha. As times are going to throw long down the right sideline. Got a man there. Almost caught. Unable to hold on to was Jerry McDuffie.
Good coverage there. In the cornerback did a good job of playing the ball and not getting called for interference.
Actually, I was kind of surprised there wasn't a flag there.
I think he turned his head back just enough at the last minute.
Do they set up the screen again to Nasir Phillips on 3rd and 10 from the 41 of North? 1:25 mark of the first quarter. Tied at 7. Back to pass. With time, throwing. Catch made. And taken down right to 36. I believe that was Patterson.
Dominic Burns, the pass complete to number 9, Isaac Patterson.
You almost just go for it here, Chris, don't you?
We've got some stuff going on here on the field. Dom Berth is going to get called for a personal foul. Brian Robinson is hot. So I don't know what was said.
Well, the question is who did they see chirping first at the 105 mark?
It might be offsetting. But they were both going at each other there, Mitchell.
That again is 6'5 versus 5'11. I did not see it happen. It's a dead ball, unsportsmanlike, on south. Boy, that's going to take you out of going for it range.
You got to make sure. I know in the heat of the battle, it's hard to you get caught up in things, but you got to think where you are in the field and what you're doing. You just cost your team 15 yards.
Yeah, you can't go on 4th and 21. You got to punt this.
4th and 6 with a doable thing on your side of the 40-yard line. So now they've got to punt the ball.
Right. Kilmeyer's a punter.
4th down.
Back to receive is Stevens.
Back deep for Westerville North, number 3, Jonathan Stevens. And the kick for the Wildcats, number 18.
Kilmeyer waiting the snap, staying back is 32. Man, that's a massive penalty, Chris. Snap back, Kilmeyer has it. Gets the punt away, a wobbler. Hits it to 25, goes sideways and out of bounds around the 21-yard line. You get good field position. They were definitely going to go for it.
Yeah.
On 4th and 6. Did he just go up and confront him? I didn't see the play.
I think there was maybe a little shimmer or something after the throw. I think Dom took a little exception to it and he got right back in the grill.
Honestly, if I was on offensive line, I'd want my quarterback doing that.
Well, you got to stand up for yourself, but you got to think about it. You got to know when to stop, too. You know, you can make your point across, but don't keep going after it.
55.9 seconds left.
I think this is the loudest I've heard this crowd. I think it's because we got the windows out tonight.
You could not ask for a better night to broadcast up in the booth. Chris and I showing off our pasty whites. Enjoying the ball game so far. Mares are up 14-0 on Darby early in that game. So Ronald Jackson and the North offense will have a 1st and 10 at their own 22 they mark it at. Three backs in the back, or two backs in the backfield. They've got both Stevens and Reynolds. Wides each way. Jackson fakes the handoff back to pass and dumped immediately. I think that was 14 who made that tackle, Ian Smith.
By number 14, Ian Smith.
A loss of about five on the play, Chris. Good defensive move there by Smith.
Playing that Leo linebacker. I believe it was. Who was the young man that got hurt last year? He was. He was the starting Leo. He must have got hurt again.
Did he?
Yeah, I can't think of his name right off the top of my head.
With the K. I have to look it up. I know who you're talking about.
Jude Kowalski. Yeah, he's usually the starting Leo, so he must have hurt himself.
I'm trying to figure out if they have to run another play before the quarter ends. And Coach Jackson has to take a second timeout, Chris, with 8.6 seconds left on the clock.
Timeout, Westerville North, their second timeout of the half.
So my wife's in a bit of a kerfuffle so far this fall, Chris, because we have a lot of deer on our property, and they like eating her plants. She does not like deer on the munch. Looking forward to getting home to Cincinnati. You're going to be watching the Buckeyes Notre Dame tomorrow night. Is that a 7:30 kick, Chris?
7:30 kick, NBC, I believe.
Definitely on NBC. My Bearcats hosting Oklahoma after blowing a game to the Miami Redhawks. Had a field goal at the end of regulation to win it, and it gets blocked, complete hack job. Coaching was not good. My Bearcats moved to 2-1, but they will host the undefeated Oklahoma Sooners. But we big
welcome to the Big 12.
That's all right. Heck, you know what? Bring them on. Bring it on. Second and 14 back at the 18-yard line. Jackson has Lem Reynolds to his right. Steps up. Passes thing down to his offensive lineman. Back to throw. Three-man rush. Looking right. Pointing things out. He's going to run. Trying to get the edge. He does. Only crosses the 20 out to the 21. Gains about 3, maybe 4 yards. It's going to be 3rd and 11. Got to be the final play of the quarter. The Battle of Westerville is tied up at 7 apiece heading to the second quarter. Back in a minute, CBUS Sports Radio Network.
Hey, it's Kirk Herbstreit from ESPN. Football has played a big part in my life, but football is also a lot more than just big plays, wins, losses, and championships. Football teaches young people about dedication, sacrifice, teamwork, and overcoming adversity. So let's respect the game and get out and support your local school. You'll be amazed of all the good things you see happening at Ohio schools.
This message brought to you by the Ohio High School Athletic Association and the OHSAA Radio Network.
Thank you for tuning in to CBUS Sports Radio for tonight's broadcast. You can follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at CBUS Sports Radio, all one word, for live updates on all our broadcasts. You can also listen to our broadcast archives on demand on our website, www.cbussportsradio.com.
Back at Wildcat Stadium, tied up 7 apiece. Big third down coming up to start the second quarter. 3rd and 11 from the 21 of the North Warriors. Unfortunately, both teams with some self-inflicted wounds there late in the first quarter, Chris.
So everybody's streaming tonight here at Westerville South. Westerville North crew is here as well. Rick Cooper, nice guy. They do a good job for North Sports.
Going to be 5 wide set for Ronald Jackson. 3 left, 2 right. The guy I like the most is Adams at 6'4", 194. He's a very good wide receiver. Jackson, again, trips left, wins right, has the snap. Looking left, pressure coming, throws left side. Off the hands of his receiver. I think that was Adams. And that falls incomplete. Adams at 6'4", tried to leap up there with one hand and snare it, but couldn't bring it in. 4th and 11, punting situation.
That brings up 4th down.
Back to receive once again is Jordan Wheeler.
Back deep for the Wildcats, number 6, Jordan Wheeler.
Got some more scores trickling in. We'll try to get those to you now. We'll definitely have them at the half for you. Talk about their dispatch
Super seven.
Their snap bounces back to Lincoln. He was on his knee, Chris.
Yeah,
and he'll be down right there at the 6-yard line.
That's huge.
He went down to his knee to pick up the ball and field it. And when you're on a knee and you're punting, you're down right there. That's a good catch by the referee.
At the 6-yard line.
So first and goal at the 6.
Boy, talking about taking a short field in a hurry.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, honestly, in that case, to me, that needs to be a rule change. But you know what they did not ask? They didn't ask me. Nasir Phillips, Dom Bertha out to try to punch it in the end zone. 3 wide set. Kilmeyer and Wheeler split wide left. Phillips has Bertha to his right. Hands it to him on the left side. At the 5, and he scampers into the end zone for 6. 6-yard touchdown run from Nasir Phillips. Puts the Wildcats up 13-7. That didn't take long, Chris. 11:49 mark, first play, or second play of the technically third. Incomplete pass, punt, and then a touchdown. Third play of the quarter.
Wow.
Boy, what a turn right there. What a turn. Ethan Rosen on to attempt the PAT. I'm going to keep it here after the PAT, just give you a few scores. Snaps good, holds good. The kick is good. Some scores from around the area. West Jeff, Chris having a great year up 14-0. Over Mechanicsburg, Johnstown 14-0 over Northridge. Pick Center 14, Newark 0. Cedarville 21 over to nothing over Madison Plains. New Albany up on Grove City 3-0. How can you predict stuff week to week, Chris?
You can in high school football.
No, you cannot.
I mean, New Albany's struggling. I mean, they're having a heck of a time.
Marysville 14, Darby 7. Grandview 14-0 over Whetstone. St. Francis, DeSales 14-0 over St. Charles, and London 14-0 over Bell Fountain. Sheridan 21-0 over the Black Bears of Riverview.
Yeah.
Liberty 7-6 over the Shamrocks. Bears 10, Olentangy 0.
The number 4 team in the state.
Seriously.
Going down to their in-district rival.
So far, anyway. It's too early to tell who's the good teams.
But I'm not taking anything away. Coach Mark Bottom, he's got a good club, no doubt.
Here's the boot. It's the longest time over the head of Stevens, and he gathered in, backing up at the 10, working his way to the left sideline at the 15, at the 20. Forced out of bounds around the 23, maybe the 24-yard line. And the first time tonight, the Warriors find themselves down, Chris, 14-7.
Yeah.
The difference to me between South September 1st.
The running game,
in
dude.
South now, they seem to know who they are. Confidence in what they're doing. I think Coach Chris is more comfortable what he's calling. Is he the O coordinator?
I'm sure. I mean, no, he has his own offense, but I'm sure that's part of the game plan preparation, but I think last week, big boost, confidence boost. You go up to Big Walnut and win up there.
Beat the Walnuts. Beat the Walnuts.
Eagles.
Beat the Eagles. Up at Big Walnut. That's a good win. Twin split way wide right. Jackson has a running back. I believe that is Lem Reynolds to his right. Wings on each side. Left wing motions to the right. Jackson running the option to the right. Hitting the backfield. Breaks a first tackle, but it's hammered down at the 19-yard line. Making that tackle, I've got that as Nao Thomas. Like they had his land of Vicroy, excuse me. Boy,
Vicroy getting the start this week at the other defensive end is Brady Krill playing offense only.
Second and 14, Chris, after a 4-yard loss. I would say, Chris, I don't know if I'm going out on a big limb here. This is probably the quickest defensive front that North has faced this year.
Oh, without a doubt. Overall team speed.
Jackson back to pass. Has time. Steps up in the pocket. Tripped up and able to break that tackle. Going to the far sideline at the 20, 25, 30, and scampers out of bounds. Just short of the first down. They mark him out of bounds at the 29. Let's call it third and about 4.
Mitch, I'm about ready just to maybe start following
whatever's easier for you. It's not going to bother me at all, sir.
I just won't be able to interject as much as I would like, but.
Do it while you're looking through the camera. Of course, it doesn't have a feedback lens there for you. Third and 4. 10:54 left in the first half. Trips right, one wide left. Jackson with the back to his right. Has a snap, going to throw a quick right side, and it's incomplete, off the mark. Trying to get that ball, I think, to numero 10, Tyler Gobler. Gobler. G-O-E-B-B-L-E-R, 5'10", 155, junior. Now you know that it's going to be in John Link's head to not put his knee down.
Number 17, John Link.
Back receive is Jordan Wheeler, standing at his own 34. Snap back to Link is good. This time Boyce a wobbler near side. That's a shank. Hits at the midfield stripe, backs up, and finally tapped down by North at the 46-yard line on their side of the field. Link had headed in his head.
Yeah. Do not kneel.
Do not kneel. Dom Berth and Nasir Phillips back out on the field. Dom Bertha has thrown effectively tonight, but it's really been Nasir Phillips with the big play so far. Running with those quick feet. Phillips with the carry left side. At the 45, down to the 44, maybe gains 2 yards on play is all. Love running in that short side of the field. That only gains him 1 yard on the play.
1 yard gain. Second down and 9.
They'll go quickly, as Chris noticed right out of the gate. They're actually going to mark at the 44, 2 yard gain. Second and 8. Two wides right. Phillips to the right of Bertha in the gun. Dom a couple of handcuffs. And somebody jumps offside.
I'll tell you right now, Westerville South in the Warriors' noggin right now.
Yes.
They've got control of this game so far, and there's a lot of mistakes happening on Westerville north side. Coach Stanley Jackson's going to have to clean that up at halftime.
Harold jumped off sides. He's a defensive lineman, 5'8", 202 senior. The second and 3 from the 39. A big difference between second and 8 and second and 3. Dom Bertha leaning forward, hands off to Nasir Phillips, hit at the line of scrimmage.
He'll
be taken down. Basic guy, did he gain anything, Chris? I'm not sure.
No, I think it's right back to the line of scrimmage. Trying to see who made the stop there. I couldn't. Those yellow numbers are hard to pick up.
I had Austin Baker.
Austin Baker on the stop. Baker, one of the linebackers in Coach Stanley Jackson's defense.
I will say this, Chris. The referees need to watch the excessive chirping going on with Brian Robinson.
There's a lot of chatter going on out
there,
isn't there?
There is indeed. Third and 3. Quick pass. It's caught by Kilmeyer at the 30. Throws the defender to the side. Loses the football.
They're going to say he was out of bounds.
They're going to say he was out of bounds. So Kilmeyer made the catch.
Fortunate for the South Wildcats there, Mitchell.
You can tell a big sigh collectively from the South fans on the near side here tonight. So first and 10, mark out of bounds at the 28.
28-yard line, first down, Wildcats.
Four wide set for Dom Bertha again. A couple claps of the hand. Looking over the sideline, the play clock at 31 seconds, got plenty of time. 9:19 left in the half as he's back to pass. So it's long down the near sideline, over the head of Kilmeyer. He missed it, Chris.
Yeah.
That was a good pass. He didn't recognize it. Did you see that?
I don't think he was expecting the ball coming to him at all.
I don't think he saw it either. That was very well placed by Dom Bertha. Second and 10. Watterson 21-0 over Hartley.
Yeah, I saw that. I was just getting ready to mention that, Mitchell, as you were going through the play there.
By the way, they're already at the half over at Davidson, 3-0. Bradley fakes a handoff, goes to Jordan Wheeler. He makes a catch, passes out of tackle at the 15, at the 10, at the 5, going for the pylon.
Got it.
He's into the end zone for the touchdown. How about Jordan Wheeler with the catch? Spun to the outside and outran the North defense to put South up 20-7. 9:05 mark, second quarter.
How many yards was that, Mitchell?
18. Rosen on its attempt to PAT.
Number 84, Ethan Rosen.
PAT kick is up, and it is good. 9:05 left in the half. Wildcats coming out strong. Yeah. They lead 21-7 on the CBUS Sports Radio Network.
Ted's Classic Cuts Barbershop, a family barbershop conveniently located in Gahanna at 345 Granville Street, Suite B. Ted's Classic Cuts gladly accepts walk-ins and appointments. Shop hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., and 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. on Saturday. So visit Ted, Kathy, John, or Debbie for all of your hair care needs. Call 614-337-8833 for an appointment. Ted's Classic Cuts, your family barbershop.
For the second time in the second quarter, South takes advantage, Chris, of very good field position as they take it in for their third touchdown of the night and lead 21-7.
Back deep for Westville North, number 3, Jonathan Stevens, and number 4, Will Solomon.
Darkwa to kick it off. Stevens back with Solomon. You mentioned, Chris, odd to have a left-footed kicker.
Yeah. Different spin on the ball, just like on anything else coming off of a lefty. The club,
punter,
the bat, the hand, the shot.
The approach, the boot, a low kick. Solomon fields it about the 17. Quickly across the 20, across the 25, across the 30. Ball's out. It's picked up by South, and they've got a turnover.
Wow.
At their own, rather the north 35-yard line. The Westerville North coaches to our right, Chris, are going ballistic and not in a good way. They'll mark it at the 34. Is this the same team we saw against the Olentangy 3 weeks ago?
No.
It is not.
No. I'm not sure it's the same team we saw last week against Delaware A's.
I have to congratulate Chris. We're talking to Sabre. I wonder if they're saying he might bend down. North offense, they're going to give it to North.
Oh, Coach Chris is beside himself.
Well, he's not the only one that might not agree with that decision.
As you can hear, we have the windows out of the press box tonight, folks. And if you hear some verbiage, we apologize for that.
Not us. Mitch and Chris shows tend to be clean. First and 10 for Ronald Jackson in the North offense. I didn't know if I thought he was down or not, Chris. It was hard for me to tell. I wasn't on the field. Now Coach Chris is going to take a timeout. Somebody was out there without their equipment on properly. Probably a good timeout, just to calm his team down a bit.
Mitchell, big score coming in from Dublin Coffin. Patriots hanging with the Rocks, 9-7 at half.
Yeah. The real team from, by the way, the real Lions up 23-7 on the dreaded 1-4 Goshen Warriors.
I'll tell you what, this is usually a good ball game.
West Jeff and Mechanicsburg.
West Jeff got a good club.
Yes, they do.
Now in the
Pick
Ohio
Central
Heritage Conference.
A slap down on Pick Central.
Well, they're not going to lose 4 games in a row.
No. But they'll make the playoffs anyway.
Well, yeah, when there's 17 teams.
And you've got to win.
Yeah. All you got to get one win. All you got to get to get in.
Yes.
Utica, good year for Utica. They're undefeated, and they're
up
taking
the
it to
wave.
Green Wave of Newark Catholic, 14-0 at home.
Getting ready for action as the timeout is over. Teams back out on the field. First and 10 from the 33 they mark it at. 21-7 South leads. Still 8:58 left to go in the quarter. Jackson, an empty backfield look. Pump fakes. And throw it long down the far sideline. He was hit as he throws. Tipped and almost picked. I think that was Jordan Wheeler. Was that? Or maybe that was Isaac Patterson. Kind of hard to see that 9-6, but Jackson got hit right as he threw, and that was a pop-up.
Someone didn't have an 870.
Yes.
Surprised something was blown out of the sky. Panthers finally get on the board at Marysville, 14-7 now. We'll have all these scores at halftime for you.
Trips left, one wide right. Ronald Jackson going to run the option to his left. Keeps it himself. Not much room as he able to bury his head and burrow out to about the 35-plus yard line. Going to bring up third and about 8. Big third down right here for North. They can ill afford to punt back to an South offense that's only stopped themselves tonight.
Third down.
Three wides will come near side. One wide left. Jackson with Lem Reynolds in the backfield with him. Jackson awaiting the snap, has it, back to pass, looking left, throwing left, man open. Adams makes a catch, about the 47-yard line, throw down of bounds with plenty of room to spare, about 8-9-yard gain when he only needed four. Out to the 47.
Good-looking ball there from Mr. Jackson on that throw.
Don't have a score on your Lions ball game tonight.
I don't think anybody's really too interested in that game tonight, to be honest with you.
Well, you would be, of course. First and 10 from their own 47. Jackson fakes a handoff. Gonna run. Makes one man miss. Weaving through traffic inside the 45 and hit hard at the 44 of South. Gains 9 yards on the play. We've got more post-play action on that field. They've got to tell you.
I think this is going to go on Westerville North. But you're right. The officiating gating crew has got to get this under control. The South coaching staff is telling people to keep their mouths
quiet,
right?
Like you said, yeah. 7:41 left in the first half. Not sure that I'm going to. Somebody with the drone?
Yeah.
And Ronald Jackson barking up a storm still.
It might get to the point where are they going to start calling offsetting?
They need to start throwing at some point.
Tossing people.
Yeah, you don't want to do that, but.
They're picking it up. They picked it up.
Off. Wow. Jeez. Man, that is an unpopular decision. Gain of 9, second and 1. 7:41 left in the half. The clock should wind. There they go, winder on up. To me, you've got to make a penalty call.
Yeah. If you're going to toss it, you got to throw it. I mean, you got to call it.
Jackson looking at the sideline for the call. Four wide set for him. Reynolds to his left. Straight back to pass, looking left, throwing down the far sideline for Adams. And he throws that one out of bounds where Adams could not catch it, nor could the defender. Why not take a shot on second and 1?
Exactly.
Probably going to go for it on fourth down anyway, down 21-7.
You got to get a quick score here to tighten the.
South gets the second half kickoff.
So, boy, that non-turnover, that non-fumble call is huge.
It's massive.
Yeah.
I mean, it could easily be 20-7 right now.
Because South had such a good offensive rhythm going.
Robinson back out there, tight end right side of the formation. See if they run near side, which is it to his right. Play clock running down.
Play clock's
stopped at 15. Down to 11, okay. They may have to take another timeout, Chris.
Under Coach 5 Jackson, now.
I think he's gonna run a quick quarterback sneak down to 5. Nice sells back in the gun, and flag comes in.
Delay a game.
Delay a game. Not
to see, Coach Jackson's pointing to the clock. The clock said 15, so he thought he had time.
Time, yeah.
That's what he's complaining about.
And he's right.
He has a valid issue.
He absolutely has a valid point. But the quarterback can always look down and see the back judge. It's whose job to call it at 5
seconds. He's going to hold it up.
Yep. Yep. So instead of being 3rd and 1, it's 3rd and 7-ish, 3rd and... I'm going to go with 3rd and 7.
Well, I understand that you're upset that the play clock wasn't what you saw it was, but there's nothing you're going to be able to do. They're not going to change anything right now. As you see, the two play clocks, now they finally sync them up at 25 apiece.
I think the referee's right. You got to get that taken care of. Because I was looking, I couldn't figure out what, because that one was at 15.
Yeah, and this was at 5.
5, and that's, because when you said 5, I said, what are you talking about? Yeah. I can see it was 15. Honestly, turn them off and keep it on the field.
That's what, if they have to, that's what they'll do. Coach Jackson's still on the field. He's 10 yards out on the field.
He does not want
this penalty.
No, I don't blame him in the least.
Coming up at halftime, we'll have both your bands here. Both Westerville North and Westerville South.
Look at Sheridan, Chris.
Sheridan's got a good ball club.
They
we
do.
Saw that out at Watkins Memorial
week number 2. My Lions up 30-7. Again, when you're playing a 1-4 team, you've got to win the game. Ain't pretty. You don't get any points, but the more games you win, the better seeding you get regardless.
You don't know when those secondary points, they might pick up 3 or 4 wins at the end of the
year.
You don't know.
And now this is ridiculous.
Coach Chris, he's making his, are they thinking about not calling the penalty?
I'm not sure. Coach Jackson's got the
referee's
ear.
Coach Chris has got the sides done over on this side, and Matt is not happy at all.
Watched a great segment today from Rich Eisen about officiating in the NFL today. The last thing you should ever want to talk about in any game
is what the officiating's done.
Right. There's a particular roughing the passer call against the Giants last night that was, to me, University of LSU, lame sauce university. But
this is taking way too long.
Make a decision
on what you're going to do.
You're taking the flow out of the game, taking the air out of the proverbial balloon.
Look at some scores coming up
while we're doing this.
And Bishop Reedy, 22-0 over Kip. That's in the second quarter. Figured Big Walnut would bounce back at home against Franklin Heights tonight. 28-0 there. Triad trying to get a win against Fairbanks. And they're getting the crowd is getting into it now, Mitchell.
I don't know that they were ever out of it, but it's becoming a little bit of fever pitch. At some point, you have to tell Coach Jackson, step off the field, let's play.
Or you're going to get a 15-yard unsportsmanlike conduct.
And you don't want to do that, obviously. Third and seven. Jackson trips wide right, one wide left. Has a snap, hands it off to Stevens. Dives down to about the 35. Ball comes out. And they're going to again say it was down 2 yards short of the first down.
Could be what, fourth and two, Mitch?
You're going.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
7:17 left in the first half. With your offensive line and a very elusive quarterback, you've got to feel like you can get 2 yards. Ball's at the 45, need to get inside the 43. This, to me, is where it would be just nice to go under center, change it up, try a QB sneak. They have one setback. Is that Reynolds or Stevens, Chris?
I believe it's Stevens with the towel.
Okay. Hand off to Stevens. Hit at the line
of scrimmage.
He's pushed back. Didn't gain anything. They'll mark him a yard behind the original line of scrimmage. That's going to be a loss of one. And the South defense able to stand up big, Chris, after a crazy sequence. Kind of thought, really, honestly, I felt like North kind of got jobbed on that delay of game.
I do understand why Coach Jackson was upset. And if you notice, the clocks are off. They're keeping it on
the
field.
And they should be.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Now, if you're Coach Chris here, do you take a shot right now?
Yes,
I would, without a doubt.
Three wide set for Tom Berth in the offense. High snap, hand off to Nasir Phillips, hitting the backfield, goes nowhere, gets pushed back, loss of a couple. Be nice for North with their defense
stood up
a bit. Loss of, almost four on the play.
Yeah, he got
about three.
He got hammered in the background. I believe it was our friend, Mr. Austin Baker, who has that huge cast on that right arm, made the stop.
Loss of two, they give him the 44-yard line, so second and 12, 6:19 remaining in the half. Bertha back to pass, steps into the throw. It's caught by Kilmeyer inside Westerville North territory, down to the 40-yard line. That'll be a gain of about 18 yards and more than enough for a first down.
Good-looking pass by Dom Bertha right there. You got a 6'6", 6'5", 6'7",
young man
out on the outside. You've got to take advantage of that.
He's been getting surprisingly good protection tonight.
Yeah.
He's getting rid of the ball quickly, too. Bertha has twins split each way. Has a snap, gives to Phillips right up the middle, has some room. Pushing inside the 35, down to about the 31. A late flag.
Jalen Wheeler's helmet's off. He's getting up slowly. He's going to have to come off
the field. Actually, Phillips has come off as well.
So probably Ian Gordon will go in at tailback, I would imagine.
Face mask call on North, and that'll add 15 yards. Depending, they can go 5 yards in high school, but I'm not sure whether
we'll have to see if he marks the personal foul or not, right?
Yes.
It's a 15-yarder.
Yeah, no doubt. Boy, what a big turn of events here. All the way down to the 16-yard line.
First down, Wildcats!
Boy, I tell you what, Mitch, this is like night and day from the other last time we were here.
It's just unbelievable. You're looking at almost...
This is the team we saw the last 2 years.
Yeah. And actually, they're... I hope still some chirping going on with Robinson and the rest of the crew here.
officiating crew stepping in.
What's Robinson doing on the offensive side of the line of scrimmage anyway? Are they taking him out of the game?
I don't know. He's coming off the field.
And I don't think they're throwing him out of the game. They're just, he's walking off. You have to watch this development. I'll tell you one thing, I don't think Coach Jackson is very happy with his young player right now. Four wide set for the Wildcats. Dominic Bertha will keep it himself on a read option. Tries to do way too much, Chris. He's going to lose yards all the way back to the 23 and
got a flag
in the middle of the field.
Penalty on the play.
Holding.
Sloppy. Getting sloppy, Mitchell.
To say the least. I'd almost decline that. I don't know if I want first and 20 or second and 17. What's your call?
I'd say first and 20.
We'll see what Coach Jackson decides to do.
You're defending the run very well here in this sequence. I mean, they really haven't really busted anything big from a running perspective, but he took the penalty.
That appears to be
at the 27-yard line.
Set at the 30 or 27, correct. The original line scrimmage was 17, so second and 20, rather, first and 20 to 5:32 mark. 21-7 South leads.
Coming up on the Ted's Classic Cuts halftime show, we'll go over area scores, go over the scoring.
Bertha back to pass, pressure coming. Screen to Phillips, he has it at the 25, at the 20. Hit hard, loses the football. North all over it, back about the 12.
So they return the favor, they get the ball on the floor, or on the carpet, I should say.
He got drilled, Chris, tried to break that tackle, ball came shooting out. North, they had three or four people there, Chris, it was a big dive for those young men to get on top of that ball at the 13?
Looks about the 12 and a half, maybe 13. You're correct, Mitchell.
Ooh,
Warriors are coming back on you.
30 to 13. Let's not get carried away, Christopher. You know New Richmond's motto, score points and defense.
Defense optional.
Optional. Two wide set for Jackson. Wings on each side of the formation. No motion, Reynolds. They'll run the option right side. Pitches to Stevens. Hit with the flag coming in at the 15-yard line. Boy, this game is just turning into a flag-a-palooza here. They'll back him up half the distance to the goal line.
Young men are letting their emotions get the best of, or the worst of them, I should say.
That's Westerville North.
5:05 left in the first half. Wildcats up 21-7 over the undefeated Warriors. This would be such a big win for them in computer points. Heading into the toughest part of the schedule, no doubt about that. Hosting Hayes next week and then off the canal the following week. OCC Capital action.
That'll be a good one down at Canal Winchester, I'm telling you.
So first and about 16. Ball at about the 6-yard line. Jackson has a snap, goes on down the left sideline for Adams. I think he pulled that in, Chris, all the way out at the 37-yard line. Boy, 6'4 against some of these shorter defensive backs. And he pulled it in. That was a good pass. That's the best pass from Ronald Jackson tonight. Cam Garcia at 5'10 just can't hang with Adams at 6'4. They'll mark it at the 36. Boy, overcoming a first and 16 with a beautiful ball. Jackson back to pass again. Pressure coming up the middle. Down the left sideline again for Adams. And it's incomplete and flags all over the place. I think Cam Garcia forced him out of bounds, Chris, at the 4:35 mark. 15-yard penalty coming. And what Garcia didn't realize is Jackson threw that to the inside. And the route went down the sideline.
Yeah.
Should be around the midfield stripe, maybe the 49 of South. Big possession for both teams. North would like to cut it to one score. They'll mark it at the South 49. 4:35 left, down 14 are the Warriors.
Ball spotted at the 49-yard line, first down and 10, Westerville North.
Action right in front of us, our busy broadcast position, the press box on the south side of the stadium. Hand off to Stevens. Works down to about the 46, gains three on the play.
Under 4.5 now in the half.
4:25.
Tackled by number 28, Preston Cowell.
They'll give him just that 3 yard gain, so make it 2nd and 7.
3 yard gain, 2nd down and 7.
North picking up the pace a bit, Chris, as they get longer in the second half, second quarter rather. Jackson pointing out the formation, moving people around. Two backs in the backfield with him, both Stevens and Reynolds. Stevens just to his left, Reynolds behind him and to his left. They generally run the read option out of this formation. He'll be straight back to pass to a screen pass to Stevens. Hit it to midfield stripe and taken down.
Nice play.
Great play that time.
Number four.
That would be Dylan Shoemaker.
Yeah. Dylan Shoemaker. The Sam linebacker.
He diagnosed that immediately. Made a great open field tackle. 3rd and 10. Jackson will have the same formation, two wides only. Play action fake, back to pass, looking right. Coming back to the near sideline, throws it, passes off the hands of Stevens and incomplete.
Ronald Jackson, pass incomplete, intended for number 3, Jonathan Stevens.
Kind of lucky there, bud.
Very lucky.
Not picked off. Like the athletic move, but you got to watch what's happening there.
Chris, I think they're going to go for it on 4th and 10 at the south 49-yard line with 3:22 left in the half. Big play in this ball game. 2nd 4th down conversion attempt for the Warriors. They were stuffed their first time on a 4th and 2. This will be a 4th and 10. Empty backfield look, and South say, hey, we're going to take it, talk this over, taking a timeout.
Wildcats. Second timeout.
What do you got score wise going on around the area, Christopher?
I was just trying to look at some other stuff here. Jackson over at Washington Courthouse, 27-14. Fairbanks still trailing Triad at home, on the road, 8-0. Mechanicsburg trailing the Rough Riders of West Jeff, 21-0. 4th team's probably in.
That's Gahan up 28-7 over Westland in the second quarter, by the way.
Green Wave still trailing Utica 14-0. North Merrimore on top of the Freddies, or Fredericktown. Halftime score down at Marysville 14-7. Monarchs on top of the Panthers. Watterson is spanking Hartley 28-7.
They got that can of whoop open up, don't they?
Good game in the OCC Buckeye. Lancaster at home against Central Cross.
Well, 10-9 right there.
Thomas Worthington's got a good club. They're 4-1. Celtics are 4-1. Are they 3-2? I think the Celtics
we'll
are 4-2.
Check those. We'll double check those standings at the half. 4th and 10 from the 49-yard line to south. Warriors trying to pick up 10 yards. Trips left, one wide right. Adams all by himself on the right side. Jackson has a snap. Four-man rush. He throws over the middle, and it's off the hands of his receiver. Incomplete. Should have been caught.
Is that Marion Walker? That
was Walker who dropped it. That was right there. That's got to be caught.
Good-looking ball. He's thrown some nice passes
he
tonight.
He has. Boy, your receiver's got to help you out.
As mentioned, Thomas Worthington and Jerome, 10-10 at half. Grove City now back on
New Albany.
New Albany, 21-13.
Tom Berth in the offense back out on the field for South with 3:15 left in the half, up 21-7. They get the kick to start the second half. Tom always tries to draw the teams offside. He's got a couple offside calls this half. Gets the play, settles in. Hands off to Nasir Phillips left side at the 50, 45. Forced out of bounds around the 43.
Nasir Phillips on the barrier.
I need a cameraman, dude.
You've got one. His name's Chris. Gain of 9 on the play.
Second down and 2.
They've got to get it just inside the 46. They're at the 47. Clock stopped at 3:09 left. Got a little chippy and sloppy and a lot of flags here in the second quarter. Phillips again off the right side through a hole at the 35, at the 30. Just breaking tackle after tackle down to the 28.
He is a stud.
He's 5, I want to get it right, 5'8", 185. A lot of power in those legs.
And he's quick.
Yes.
I mean, he moves side to side laterally very well.
Kudos to the offensive line, by the way.
Yeah, they're doing a great job. And gets a much bigger defensive line. They're opening up some holes straight ahead.
I wonder if they're missing Janarius Strickland in there.
I would think so. 306 pounds at the defensive nose tackle.
Three wides right for Don Bertha. Clock running, 2:43 left in the half. I just don't, it went from 2:43 to 2:36, now it's at 2:37, and it's crazy. Bertha to keep it himself at the 25, forced out of bounds around the 24. In today's day and age, you have a clock that will not count every second.
This is the digital.
How the coach is supposed to manage the game? Gain of about six on the play.
22-yard line, second down.
Called second and four.
Well, I can tell you're not a fan of it, Mitch.
No, I'm not in the least. 2:12 left in the half.
I tell you what, Don Bertha looks very confident tonight, doesn't he?
Not making very quick on his decisions.
The only thing, he got a little upset with Mr. Robinson earlier in the game.
He's back to pass, pressure coming. He throws to Kilmeyer. Makes a nice hands grab at the 10-yard line. First and goal, South. Boy, I tell you what, Kilmeyer's got some muckers on him,
yeah,
doesn't he?
He does.
He got some hand on that ball and just pulled it right in.
Bertha stood in there and took a wallop as well.
Blitz came right up the gut, and he was able to throw it out to his big 6'7 wide receiver. Technically, X back. Under a minute 40 left in the half. If I was South, I'd milk this out as long as I could. Don't want to give Ronald Jackson another shot. At the 10-yard line of first and goal. Hand off to Phillips, hitting the backfield, spins out of that tackle, but thrown down for no gain on the play. Several people there to bring him down.
Tackled by number 15, Alex Troyer.
Alex Troyer on the stop for Westerville North. Under a minute 20 now, Mitch.
Loss of about 3 yards. Second goal back at the 13. Technically, it's inside the 13, but closer to the 13 than the 12. Bertha with two wides left, one right. He's back to pass. Goes into the end zone for Kilmeyer, and Kilmeyer went to the sideline. He threw into the end zone, incomplete. Third and goal from the 12-ish.
A little miscommunication once again.
At the half, we'll have scores for you. We've got the bands for you. Dispatch. Super 7, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Thrill a moment.
Hopefully go over maybe some pewter rankings as well. Pewter rankings, yes. As they were released this week. Joe Itell does a great job with the OSHA release, the official ones.
Third and goal from the 12. Here's a pass and a flat to Phillips and almost intercepted.
Was that Nolan?
That was Nolan.
Nolan.
Nolan, sorry.
Nolan.
Yeah. Boy, that was six if he makes that grab.
So they're going to bring out the kicking team here, right?
This is no problem for
Rosen's
Ethan
got a good
Rosen.
Leg.
Yeah, he does.
He gets that under. This is going to be what? About a
30-yarder? It's going to be from the hash. Right hash. We're going to spot it right at the 20-yard line. So it'll be a 30-yard field goal attempt for Rosen. Just maybe a yard off the right hash with 50.9 seconds left. Snaps a little high, but the hold's down. The kick is up, and it is.
He got it through.
No good.
No. Okay.
No good. Oh, we've got a whistle before the kick.
Timeout.
Timeout South.
So, Coach Chris.
Okay, going to get another attempt at this, I would think. I'm sure he likes the idea of 24-7 going into the half.
Oh, without a doubt.
Make it a pretty big lead for the...
I think just a bit of a high snap there. The holder did a good job of gathering the ball, but I think it just threw Ethan Rosen off just a bit.
Just enough. I think my internet... What is...
I think the internet everywhere, because I'm getting all of our cameras. The ones that are connected to the internet are dropping. The POE cameras are staying pretty strong, but there's only two of them. So I do apologize, folks, if I'm moving the cameras a little bit quickly and it is causing you a little nausea.
I get irritated when I tell my computer to connect to my phone and it connects to your network. I didn't ask it to connect to your network. I just connect my phone. And try this 29-yard field goal attempt is Ethan Rosen. You're right, Chris. That snap was high, but the hold was down. I think the timing was just a bit askew. Now the officials are having another caucus. Seriously, folks? It's 8:15, and we haven't gotten to the half yet. What in the world can you possibly have to discuss? 50.9 was the clock before this play.
Yeah, there was no, the timeout was before the clock started.
Correct.
So this is a 29-yarder, not a 30.
Yes. Just inside the 20-yard line. Snap, dribbles back, the holes down, the kick is up. And it is
no, he pulled that
no
off.
Good.
He pulled that off to the left. Once again, the snap was low that time. Yeah. The young man did a good job of corralling and getting it down, but it just threw the timing off.
So 47.3 seconds left. North is going to get another shot. It's the simple things. Like I always tell people, it's an extra point snapper. You know the only time they talk about you.
Being an ex-long snapper, you relate to that, don't you?
They only talk about you when you mess it up. Back to the offenses. Side of football is Westerville Warriors. Westerville North Warriors, technically. Boy, this has been an uncharacteristically long first half.
Sorry, folks. I have to clean the...
Get the powder off the lenses. Warriors in a four-wide set. The lone setback, I believe, is Stevens to the left of Jackson. He has the snap. Pats the ball a couple times, rolls out to the left. He's going to run. Runs out of bounds across the 25 and out of bounds at, we got a flag down.
That's a shocker.
Holding call on North.
Holding against Westfield.
So first and 10 from the 10-yard line. If we ever get to the second half, Westerville South is going to get the kick, Chris.
Yes.
We'll get the receiver. Remember, make it there.
First down and 20.
You wonder if your coach Jackson say, okay, I'm backed up. Maybe try a couple deep passes, but South is down to one timeout. Do they have any timeouts left, Chris?
South has one. No, they're done for the half. Coach Jackson does have one left.
I'd be half tempted to run this out. First and 20 from the 10. Jackson again with the five-wide set. Back to pass. They're going to throw long down the middle of the field. It's tipped and almost intercepted.
Patterson.
I believe it's Patterson, yes.
Yeah, he's done a good job on the defensive end. He's had a couple drops on the offensive side, but he's played good on the defensive side of the ball tonight.
So here's my suggestion to Coach Jackson. Hand the ball off or run it. South has no timeouts. Get to the half, regroup, get your troops more disciplined, come out to play in the second half. Three wides left, two wides right for Ronald Jackson. See if he runs a QB draw or he'll just go back and shuck it. He's going to pass again. Four-man rush under pressure. Going to throw, and it is caught out around the 23-yard line.
Yeah.
Why did the clock stop?
To number 29.
23 seconds. Now, how are you supposed to manage this as a coach when you don't know how much time is left on the clock?
Ball spot at the 22-yard line.
Down to
third
17.
Down.
15. This is really bad, folks. Down to 13 seconds. Jackson again back to pass. We think just under 10 seconds left. Another flag. Another throw. It's picked off and dropped.
Ronald Jackson pass incomplete.
Is that Patterson again?
Yeah, Isaac.
No, that was Wheeler.
Wheeler. Was it Jordan Wheeler?
Yes, it was.
I think he saw, and we have an injured Westerville North Warrior.
Adams, I think, got lit up there.
Hopefully he is okay.
Boy, there. North, you are lucky that was not a pick six.
Yes, he had a train going with him.
And he had the speed to get there.
So now, honestly, I think you just kneel on it.
I don't think you have enough time. It's fourth down, isn't it? Unless if South declines a penalty, it's fourth down with 3.1 seconds left. I'd make him snap it. Adams is walking extremely gingerly, Chris.
He is. Is that a shoulder, the way he's leaning to
his
left?
It's like his left shoulder, right?
Yeah. Just speculating. Hopefully the young man will be okay.
Unfortunately, folks, we apologize. We put the sloppy in a sloppy Joe second quarter here.
Yeah, this has been not a very cleanly played ball game. Delaware Hayes all over Kilbourne, which we would expect tonight. 24-0
tonight. No surprise at all.
Olin Tanji on top of the rocks, 14-9 in the third. They're in the third quarter. We're not even at halftime yet. Davidson will be done.
Davidson probably is done. They're going to run another third down play. I don't understand why you took this penalty, but third and 18, ball back at the 12-13-yard line. Jackson hands off this time. It's Stevens' left side. He's across the 15 and out of bounds. I'm assuming the half is over, but I don't know.
Number three, Jonathan Stevens on the carry.
Jeez, now we have a Westerville South Wildcat down.
That's the end of the first
half. That's the end of the first half.
Wildcats 21.
Well, it's 21-7 Westerville South. I'll stop whining about the clock. We'll come back with the Ted's Classic Cuts halftime show in a couple, 3 or 4 minutes. Have the band for you and have a bunch more halftime chat as South leads this battle of Westerville 21-7 on the CBUS Sports Radio Network.
High school sports teach kids so many life lessons.
But less than 5% of high school student athletes play sport in college.
That's why it's so important that youth sports coaches go beyond the X's and O's.
And teach skills that will stay with kids long after their playing days are done.
So who is a coach that coaches beyond?
A coach who cares.
When I coach beyond, I am authentic.
I know that I can count on my coaches to show up every day.
I know that I can talk to my coach on and off the court.
We all want to win. But coaching is about relationships.
My coach creates a sense of belonging
for everyone in our program.
A coach is a teacher and a role model.
My sport is my last classroom of the day.
I'm still learning after the school day ends.
We establish expectations for being a member of our school community.
I'm held accountable.
And I think about more than myself.
We place our student athletes' physical and mental health as our top priority.
My coach creates a safe environment
to practice and compete.
That's why it's so important that coaches go beyond the X's and O's.
Please join the Ohio High School Athletic Association, Life Sports at The Ohio State University, and the Susan Crown Exchange as we continue with our goal to train 1 million coaches.
We can all coach beyond.
At the Ohio High School Athletic Association, our student athletes are going pro at being
coachable,
a good student,
responsible,
dependable,
respectful.
I'm going pro at being
a good student,
a good student,
a good teammate,
responsible.
I'm going pro at being
coachable,
a good student,
dependable,
a good teammate.
Representing my school,
I'm going pro at being
a good student.
A good student.
Responsible.
Let's go pro at respecting the game.
Respect 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 the game.
Buckeye football great and NFL Super Bowl champion Jim Lachey on sportsmanship.
Winning and losing can teach kids many lessons, but high school sports are truly about respecting your opponent, representing your school, and building the foundation for a lifetime of success. High school sports create memories that last a lifetime. And member schools of the OHSAA are committed to following a high set of standards. Whether it's on the field or in the stands, we can all do our part to respect the game.
This message brought to you by the Ohio High School Athletic Association.
What's your favorite high school sports memory? A late-inning rally? A game-winning shot? A photo finish? Maybe it's a pep rally or a pregame ritual. Maybe it's the euphoria of a late-night bus ride home after a hard-fought win. Maybe it's having pizza with teammates after the game. Now, imagine if it never happened at all. School sports need your help. With budgets getting tighter, it's more than the games that are on the line. It's all the traditions, the community pride, the culture of your hometown high school, plus all those memories that are on the line, too. What can you do? It's simple. Buy a ticket when you can. Go to a game. Take the whole family. Let's do everything we can to keep those cherished school sports memories alive.
This message presented by the Ohio High School Athletic Association and the Ohio Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Thank you.
But back at Wildcat Stadium, we're going to turn it over to the Westerville South High School Marching Band as, oh, I'm sorry, is this Westerville North? I apologize, Chris. Westerville North High School Marching Band scored the half. Warriors trail 21-7.
Welcome back, everybody. Getting set for the second half here of the Redstone Warriors taking on the Grandview High Bobcats. So far, the Bobcats are up 35-8 as we enter this second half. Logan Morris on the call, and of course, my friend, my pal, my broadcast colleague, Scott Murphy. Scott, what do you take away from the first half, and what do you think the mindset should be for Redstone?
Back at Westerville South High School, Wildcat Stadium, Mitch Polybagus and Chris Coakley. By the way, a complete boff on my part. I was told that Davidson was hosting here at school. They're hosting Olentangy Orange, and they're down 10-0. Chris, of course, they're at the end of the third quarter, and we're 14 minutes away from starting our second half here tonight.
So good job there by the Westerville North High School band. We're going to take a quick break. We'll come back here in just a second on CBUS Sports Radio.
Looking for future sports teach young people how to be effective leaders. It includes learning to listen, accepting responsibility, being a good role model, and it's about respect. The result, it transcends sports. It gives us hope for the future. This message presented by the Ohio High School Athletic Association and the Ohio Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association. There's just one place where students are students first, and athletics are played with purpose and perspective. There's just one place where a team is more than a group of individual agendas. It's a catalyst for demonstrating the potential of the collaborative spirit. There's just one place where players, coaches, and fans experience the exhilaration that happens when an entire community rallies behind the school team. That place is your local high school. High school sports offer more than the joy of competition. Studies show that student athletes are more likely to enjoy greater levels of achievement in other areas of their life. Confidence they need to be leaders in life, even as they unite communities like nothing else. High school sports, a winning part of a complete education. This message presented by the Ohio High School Athletic Association and the Ohio Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Let's take a time out to talk about educational athletics. That means that school sports are an extension of the classroom. Student athletes earn the privilege of participation in sports by succeeding during the school day first before they put on the team uniform later. Student athletes prove that with better attendance records, higher GPAs, and fewer discipline issues than non-student athletes. That's what it means to be a part of the Ohio High School Athletic Association.
This is what matters. This is beyond X's and O's. This is the difference mutual respect makes. This is what character looks like. This is what defines us in Ohio. This is sportsmanship. School sports, it's not the outcome that matters most, but the way the games are played. This message presented by the Ohio High School Athletic Association and the Ohio Interscholastic Athletic Administrators Association.
Back at Westerville South High School is the Westerville South High School marching band now on the field. They've got the young players out there as well, Chris.
Looks like the middle schoolers are out there with them as well.
Indeed. Actually, it's been quite well received. It was funny, Chris. I didn't tell you this, but we got here very early tonight because we anticipated parking problems. I generally roll in, strolling at 6, lay stuff down, and start flapping my gums shortly after Chris getting here significantly earlier to set up. But I walked in, and the lady said, hey, your name's not on the list. Do you always come here? I said, wait. No, I wanted to say something smart, Alec, but it was packed when 5:30 when we got in. People just
I gave Jeff, the athletic department, athletic director, both of our names. They just weren't on the list. It had two people there, so I'm not sure. But we appreciate them letting us come out as always, and here the great support here for CBUS Sports Radio at Westerville South High School.
Davidson is scoring on a 99-yard touchdown run.
That makes it 10-7,
right? If the PAT is good, that's what you would anticipate. But the first half, Chris, a lot of mistakes by both teams. Loss of composure by both teams. But South made more plays, 21-7. I guess two big plays that stand out when you have the punt when Lynx kneeled down to scoop up the snap.
Make a six-yard drive.
Right, six-yard drive, and then also, no doubt about it, when you hold them on fourth and two, right down here in front of us. We're just to the right, the east of the 50-yard line. Fourth and two, and you make them lose a yard, and you get the ball yourself and go down and score.
Without a doubt. Scoring here in the first half, Westerville North got on the board on 1 yard touchdown run by Ronald Jackson at the 8:35 mark, 6-0. Link PAT is good, 7-0 Warriors. Nasir Phillips, the 20-yard touchdown run in the first at 6:20, makes it 7-6. Rosen with his extra point knocks it up at 7 apiece. A few seconds later in the second quarter at the 11:49 mark, Phillips once again on a 6-yard touchdown run. Makes it 7-14 with a Rosen PAT. Wheeler then on a 18-yard Bertha pass at the second quarter with 9 minutes, makes it 20-7. Cats here at home. Rosen PAT is good. 21-7. And at the 50.9 mark in the end of the second quarter, Rosen attempted a 30-yard field goal. It went wide left. So your score here is 21-7, Cats at home.
So the Cats get the ball to start half number two. They're certainly going to, try to continue to feature Nasir Phillips, who's run very, very strongly.
He's had a strong game. Don Bertha's played well, too.
He's thrown effectively. A couple drop passes hurt them. But Westerville North, what do they got to do to try to slow down this South offense? They've not been able to contain them so far tonight.
Well, and you made a very good point. I think with Mr. Strickland not being in there to plug up that middle, because that's where they're attacking. Nasir Phillips is making his yardage between the tackles and making people miss there. You don't have Mr. Strickland's 306 pounds, 6'4" frame in there to take up a lot of space. I'm not saying the young man's in there not doing a good job, but he is your starter for a reason. He is out tonight, and Westerville South is taking care of that, or taking advantage of that.
Right, no doubt about it. They've played well along the offensive line. Let's go ahead, Chris, take a look at some of the other scores in the area. We'll go through these kind of quickly because I know you like to talk about the Dispatch Super 7.
Let me bring the stats up here, buddy, and then we'll start going here. Are you at the beginning, and who do you have on?
I have Fairbanks showing up at the top. Well, tell you what, I can see them on your...
Okay, let me flip us over here. Let me take the graphic off, and boy, I really need a producer to do this without me. Go ahead, sir.
Marysville 14-7 over Darby. Orange up 10-7 on Davidson, who just scored a touchdown. Reedy 30-7 over Kip, or 30-0 rather. Triad 8-0 over Fairbanks. West Jeff 21-0 over Mechanicsburg. Elgin 52-0 over Crestline.
They're undefeated, Elgin is too.
Northmore 35-0 over the Freddies. Bloom Carroll 35, Fairfield Union 3. Scioto with the touchdown to make it 7-7 against Winchester. Are you kidding me?
So Dublin Side is showing up tonight.
Bishop Watterson 28-7 over Hartley. Newark trailing Utica 14-7. Tied up at 10 over Thomas Worthington. Dublin Jerome and Thomas Worthington. Grove City 21-13 over New Albany. Pandora Gilboa 27-14 over Worthington Christian. Shawnee 14-7 over North Union. Northridge 14-14 tied up with the Johnstown Johnny. Cedarville 35, Madison Plains 14. Miami Trace 14-0 over McLean. Grove City Christian 17-7 over Miller. The Cruiser 17-0 over
Reynoldsburg.
Way down. Yes, no doubt about it. Hamilton Township are clear for 22-16 over Pleasant.
Township's a good team. That's something we're going to probably look at in the playoff situation, my friend.
They lead 29-7 over Amanda. He 33, Lakewood 0. Grandview 35-16 over Whetstone.
Yes, our friends over at CBUS Local have that game tonight.
35-0 Logan Elm over Liberty Union. London 36, Bell Fountain 6. Sheridan 55-0 over the Black Bears. Shamrock 17-14 over the Patriots. Gahanna 35-7 over Westland. Delaware 24-0 over Kilbourne at the half. Independence 22-0.
That's big. That's South having a good season, and Independence is sticking it to them.
Over South. Columbus County 25-0 all over Whitehall.
Yeah, Coach Miller trying to stay undefeated at 6-0.
Pick Central 41-0 over Newark. No surprise there. Hard Northern 21-0 over the Rockets. Is that Ridgemont?
Ridgedale.
Ridgedale, sorry. New Philly 22-3 over the Yellow Jackets. Going just a bit fast.
Sorry,
Marion,
buddy.
Franklin 24-6 over the Scots. Our score again 21-7. West Liberty 25-7 over Northeastern. 35-7 over Northeastern. Briggs 13, Eastmore 7. Mifflin 14, Centennial 0. Highland trailing the Shelby Whippets 26-14. East Knox 14-0 over Mount Gilead. Central Crossing 15-10 over Lancaster. Man.
Hillclimbers coming back in it.
Jonathan Alder 27 or Urbana 21. 21-7 to sales over St. Charles. Buckeye Valley leading Bexley 21-14. Centerburg 21. Cardington Lincoln Pirates 0. Nubians 26, West Cowboys 0. Taze Valley 28-7 over Circleville. Jackson 28-14 over Washington. Burn Union 32, Millersport 0 at the half. Bears 17-7 over Olin Tangi. Prep 26, Wheelersburg 3.
A down Wheelersburg team.
Is it a down Wheelersburg team?
I'm only saying that because they have two losses, and that's down for them.
36-0 over Lyndon McKinley. Big walnut, 42-7 all over Franklin Heights. Pick North tied up of 14 apiece with Westerville Central.
I'm not trying to. Well, you know who I want to win this game, don't you?
Well, Pick North.
Why would I want that?
Better matchup at the end of the season.
It does, but it gives me a game up in the OCC Ohio from your Gahanna.
Granville 21-7 over Licking Heights.
Tied
up
game.
Bradley and Arlington 10 apiece. Upper Scioto 32-0 over Ridgemont. Now Licking Valley 14-0 over Zanesville is the final score we have there.
Yep, at the bottom.
The real score that we want to talk about, 37-13, my Lions up on the dreaded Goshen Warriors, slapping them around.
Nobody even knows who those teams are.
I do, and that's all that matters. If I get done with my job early tomorrow night and I can't make it back up here, I will go watch my mighty Lions play. If I can get done in time.
You mean next week, you mean?
Yeah, I'm going to be doing a job about, 20 minutes from Indy. If I get done, it'd be later in the day. Yeah, it'd be hard to get over here by 4 o'clock.
Depending on what we're going to do, we're going to kind of collaborate next week with CBUS Sports Local, do something. And he has offered to provide me a cameraman.
Really?
So I might take advantage of that next week.
Yeah, man, here you go.
You want to do this Dispatch Super 7
ahead.
Week?
Go ahead. Call it. You've got him. I can't see him as well. Go ahead.
Looking here, the Dispatch Prep Super 7. This is week 6. Again, Lincoln remains in the number one spot at 5-0 with 62 points. Pick North right behind him. Dropped down a few points. Gahanna with that big explosion.
Massive.
Went over Central last week. North at 5-0 with 55 points. Hillier Bradley coming in at 5-0 with 40 points. Olin Tangi, the number four team in the area and the number four team in the AP poll, I believe, with 30 points at 5-0. They're trailing Berlin, the number five team, 4-1 with 14 points. Canal, Winchester, 5-0, 13 points. And Dublin, Kaufman, the final team in the top seven. At 11 points at 4-1, also getting votes, Upper Arlington, Watterson, Hilliard Davidson, Westerville North, Harvest Prep, and Pick Central.
So the top 10 teams in D1, St. Ed's, no surprise. Pick North, not a surprise. Cincinnati Princeton, not a surprise. Olin Tangi, surprise. Gahanna, not a surprise. At 5, Bradley, surprise to me at 6. Then Milford down from my area, Perrysburg.
Camp McKinley.
We'll see. Things will sort itself out. D2, Massillon, Washington. Big win over St. Ed's last week.
15-13. It was huge.
That's massive win. Hoban, Cincinnati, Winton Woods. Made by local. Nobody local. D3. We've got Watterson, number four in the state. I think that's well deserved. That's probably the most.
Honestly, I think
ranking there.
I think Watterson might be even a little higher than that, to be honest. It should be a little bit higher than Division III.
D4, Clinton Massey down in the same league my Lions play, number one. Sheridan, ranked four. That's a good ball team right there.
Logan Elm coming in as well out of Central Ohio.
D5, not a lot of local representation. Harvest Prep is eighth in the state.
You're not going to get anything. Danville may be in Division VII. West Jeff in Division VI in the three spot, Mitchell.
Here's a real shock that Marion Local's number one. Ansonia get a vote? Marion Local's got.
Well, they're all in the same league. You got three teams in Division 7 in the top 10 out of the Mighty Mac.
I know. Well, there's a reason they call it the Mighty Mac.
You see Coldwater anywhere?
Yeah, Coldwater was in
Division
4.
D5. Right? D5, okay.
Yeah, they're number two behind Perry.
I mean, there was one year they had three state championships out of that league.
Well, I mean, you look at D5, Perry, Coldwater, Liberty Center, Valley View, Oak Harbor, Ironton. And it's always tough for Prep to get past Ironton because I think they match up well physically with them.
So it looks like we're getting ready back.
What does that clock mean?
I think they're resetting it now. I just got to make sure I get the cameras positioned correctly here. Mitchell?
All righty. Wildcats will get the ball. They're going to receive it in the east portion of the field. A unusual east-to-west running field here in Central Ohio.
Well, you know where the old football field was, don't you? There where the buses were.
That's the first playoff game I did. And it was Brian White, Hilliard Davidson over number one-seeded Westerville South back in the day when they had some studs on that team.
Also deep for the Wildcats, number 10, Antonio Armistead.
So getting ready to get it back underway. Chilling off. It's cooling off just a little bit.
Could it be any nicer? We'll get you a second half kickoff temperature here in just a second.
Appreciate you do tuning in. If you are on the audio side, you want to come over and look at the video. And like I said, I promise I'm trying not to make you nauseous, folks, with camera operation tonight. But we're doing the best we can to bring you some high school sports here in Central Ohio.
64 beautiful degrees here in Westerville, Ohio. As Link set to kick it off. Approaches the ball, gets the boot away down the far side. It hits at the 11, fielded just inside the 10, bringing it near side across the 20, 25, twisting across the 30 out to the 32. Ian Gordon, not expected to be back there from what we had anyway, but nice return out to the checking for that final spot, about the 33-yard line. Just underway in the second half at 8:46, Christopher. That does not bode well for an early exit, does it?
No, I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to be nice to you tonight. I'm going to let you cut out of here, and I'll just break everything down tonight.
I'll probably still wait because I don't want to face the crowds. I'll probably just wait with you a few minutes anyway.
Well, I was just being nice. So.
Well, I'll tap out eventually. You know me. First and 10, waiting for the Wildcats' first play. They get the call from the sideline. Bertha with Phillips just behind him. Gives it to him right side. Makes a cut at the line of scrimmage and able to power out to the 35. That's a hard-earned 2 yards right there.
Tackled by number eight.
Just as a note, Chris, Brian Robinson back out there. He was just, actually, Chris are going to give him maybe just a gain of one on the play.
Baker on the stop from that linebacker position. Once again, he's been very active tonight, Mitchell.
Austin's a 6-foot senior, 188-pounder. Second and 9. Three wides left for the Wildcats. Hand off to Phillips left side. Trying to get to the edge, he does at the 35. Cross the 40-yard line, we'll see where they mark him out of bounds. The difference between this week and last week is really the skill players of North, I think, have a, dare I say, a little bit speed difference, a speed advantage on Delaware Hayes.
Oh, yeah, you mean from South compared to Hayes?
Yes.
Without a doubt. And not that Hayes doesn't have some good skill get positions. You're right, the speed has turned up just a bit tonight.
Third and 3 from the 40-yard line, 3 wides right. Ball in the left hash. They like to run the short side. Bertha with the hard count. Everybody looks to the sideline and gets the call. Bunch of hand gesticulations. Third and 3. Quarterback keeper right side. Trying to get to the outside is Bertha. Hit the 40 and take it down right away.
Put his shoulder down, went into two players. Came up, I believe Stevens was on the stop from the safety position.
Actually, I've got Lem Reynolds on
Reynolds
tackle,
on that?
It doesn't matter. It's going to be a loss of a yard and 4th and 4. And
I'm sorry. I saw the 3. That's all I saw.
It's all right. Nothing better that could have happened for North.
Yeah, without a doubt. Good stop defensively for them coming out of halftime.
Punter is Kilmeyer.
He's got to get a good one off. He hasn't got a good one off yet tonight.
Stevens back deep. Standing at his 30 and gets another safety back with him. I believe that's Solomon. There's a snap. There's a kick. It's a better kick coming near side to Solomon. Fields it at the 27. Racing to the sideline, and he goes out of bounds. That should be a flag right there.
Got to be smart. That
got hit late.
Number 8 on the penalty.
Xavier Berry.
You cannot do that out of bounds, and one of the defensive coaches gets in his grill right away.
It wasn't even close. And you're going to give him fantastic field position,
plus
too.
It's a safety issue.
Yes. He got hit into the bench.
Yes. So I know, guys, it's easy. We've all been down on the field of battle, and you get caught up into it, and you just got to be smart. You just can't make silly penalties like that. And you know, you're going to attack on 15. You're going to be on the Westerville South side of the field here.
Indeed.
Should take it down to the 45, right?
Absolutely. But close to that. We'll double check the exact spot. 46-yard line. What great field position for North. A chance to make a quick statement here in half number 2. Ronald Jackson and crew out for their first possession. One setback, I believe, is Lem Reynolds. Two wides left, two wings in this formation. Back in motion. Jackson will keep it around the left side, pitches to his back at the 45-yard line, bounces outside the 40, cuts back, and dives all the way down to the 35. Nice run. That's a gain of about 12 yards and a first down. Maybe 11, but still a good run.
That's where he's most dangerous.
Oh, yeah.
And not that he's not having a good night throwing the ball. He's had a lot of balls drop.
But again, South, they had nobody out there.
Yeah, you've got to get to contain and seal that.
That's just good blocking by North. First and 10, South 35-yard line. North down 21-7, 10:08 left in the third quarter. Jackson going to run the option left side, right side rather. He's in the backfield and taken down.
Looks like Zay Furman again.
Zay Furman again.
Boy, he is a force on that defensive line. As Mitchell said, he plays that anchor, which is the short side of the field on the defensive end, and he they don't get around his side.
No.
Loss of one on the play.
That's a one-yard loss back to 36, second 11.
You notice the up-tempo here that they're going a little bit quicker.
I think it makes sense. Try to get your little mojo for your own troops. Two wides and two wing backs. Jackson going to run the option left. Cuts back, 35, 30, dives down about the 28-yard line. You're right, they run away from Zay Furman.
Yeah.
Good call, because London Vic Roy is 195 pounds. That's 40-pound difference on your defensive ends. Third and about three, we'll call it. North moving effectively here after a three and out from South. Helped by a 15-yard penalty. They run the option that way again. Jackson hitting the backfield. Throws it backwards and diving on it back at the 30-yard line. I think that was either Stevens or Reynolds, but that was an ill-advised last-second pitch.
Sometimes, you know, you want to try to do just a little bit too much.
Got no one to hold him.
Yeah.
You got no one to fold him.
Okay, Kenny.
Some of our listeners, who the heck is, what song is that? The Gambler, Kenny Rogers. Fourth and five from the 30-yard line.
This would be a good stop here for South if they can come up. And
they're going to go for it on fourth down. I would be floored if they don't.
Now.
Oh, it is fourth down. I apologize. I thought it was third. My bad. Fourth and five. Trips right. One wide left. Jackson in the gun. Back to his right. High snap. Rolls right. Throws. And it is.
That's trapped. That's trapped.
Incomplete. Incomplete. Trying to get it to.
I think it would have been short anyway.
It had been dependent on the spot. As
Gubler, right?
Gubler, yes. I mean, why did I think that was third down? I was faked out by my own self there. Sometimes I think Jackson doesn't present his feet to the target, if that makes sense. It's all arm sometimes. And he's thrown some fantastic balls tonight. Just been a bit inconsistent.
Yeah.
Chris shaking his head as my Lions are up 43-13 over the dreaded Goshen Warriors. First and 10 from their own 30-yard line. Quick throw. And Jordan Wheeler can't hang on that pass. He's got to make that catch.
Yeah. I've said this every week. Playing in the slot and playing in the wide out. Like position coach, you touch it. You better catch it.
And that was just off his hands. I'll tell you who has the best hands on this team offensively. Catching-wise? Kilmeyer.
Oh, I think so.
Don't you think so?
Is that Phillips in? Is Gordon in spelling that running back? I can't see the
numbers. I can't tell from here. Bertha back to pass. There's a long down the left hash and over the head of everybody.
Dominic Bertha passing.
Now that is Nasir Phillips, Chris.
Okay.
Double checking. That is Nasir out there. Big third and 10 coming up for North. Would love to, of course, force another three and out.
Trying to see if there's any finals. There are so many of these games into the fourth quarter.
We are way behind at 7:58 remaining in the third. Three wides left, one right for Tom Bertha. Back to pass. Looking left side, throwing a slant route. Should have been picked off. Right through the hands of number five, who's not a starter. But, boy, he is not going to be happy with himself. That was Javier Matthews. Got to make that pick.
He's not going to like the film room tomorrow morning.
No. Got to make that grab.
Back to kick for the Wildcats. Number 18,
28
Tyler
points
Kilmeyer.
In the first half, and second half was starting out a little bit slow.
Yeah, opening drives both profited points for both teams.
Kilmeyer back to punt, standing at his 15, awaiting the snap. Has it. Good snap. Punt away, low kick, end over end. Stevens lets it hit, go back. Inside the 30, picks it up around the 25, comes near side at the 30. At the 35, he's got room left side. 40, 45, 50-yard line. 45 to the sideline at the 35, at the 30, and he'd be pulled out of bounds around the 20.
Wow.
Stevens has got some speed himself. That's 30, 40, 50.
Well,
it
almost looked like he ran around the tracks, what it did.
He did. Came near side, took it to the left side, had room.
Brought out of bounds at the 20-yard line, first down and 10, Westerville North.
So great field position for the Warriors once again. Coach Stanley Jackson has to be proud of that effort by his return man.
Of the split the pot, the winner will take home $200.
Once again, we appreciate Jeff Good, the athletic department, the athletic director here, for letting us to come out tonight. Always nice, the booth staff here as well at Westerville South High School.
First and 10 at the 20. Great field position for North. Looking to get back, not that they're out of the game, but to get within one score. Three wide set for Jackson, two backs in the backfield flanking him. Hands off to Lim Reynolds. That this South defense has been stout right up the middle. Just haven't given anything.
Well, they're playing that big offensive line against a three with a three-man front.
Right down by number 52, London Vicroy.
Vicroy with the stop from his defensive end position.
So a gain of one on the play only.
Second down and nine.
That will continue my statements. Never afraid of my own opinions. Run the read option.
Yes.
The core, the fullback guy. Yeah, has not been there much tonight. Jackson, three wides once again. Wing on the right side of the formation. And we've got flags before the play.
It's going to be a legal shift, I believe.
Dead ball, you're right.
Procedure.
In the backfield right now, Chris, I've got 32, I think, in there for North.
I'm having a hard time picking up those light jersey colors. There is no 32 on this on the sheet unless they've got it on the supplemental that they provided.
Childress, yes. Caden Childress.
Oh, yes. He wore zero last week.
Okay. Childress is out there. Stevens is out there. And Reynolds is out there. So their trio of running backs. Childress and Reynolds be in the backfield. Now Stevens shifts into the backfield and Childress up to the line of scrimmage. Second and about 13 after that penalty. Jackson back to pass, looking left, throwing left, got a man open, and he throws it to his outside shoulder, and he can't make the grab. He was open.
Yeah.
That was a touchdown if he leads him down the sideline just a bit towards the end zone.
Threw it to the wrong side.
Third down and 14.
Again, four down territory. 6:33 left in the third. 21-7. South leads this one. A lot of action in the first half and picking up some of that second quarter bad mojo. Four wide set for Ronald Jackson. He has the snap, looking right, stepping up, throwing across the middle, and is tipped and knocked away. I believe that was Patterson that got there. And knocked that out of the hands of the wide receiver. I think he tried to get it to Gubler, I believe.
Gubler once again, number 10.
Wildcat Stadium, that brings up fourth down.
Fourth and 14. You felt like you had confidence in your kicker. You might give it a go, but it would be a 40-plus yard.
Yeah. I can't believe that young man from Kaufman kicked a 52-yarder to win the game.
After a delay game penalty,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So they've got to get just to the 10-yard line, Chris. We'll call it fourth and 14. Three wides right, one wide left. Jackson with the back to his left. Jackson has the snap a little bit high. Pressure coming, flushed out to the left. Pumping, throwing into the end zone, and it is intercepted.
Yes.
Yes, indeed it was. Probably should have just knocked it down because he gave him bad field position. That's number 10 on the pick, Chris.
Antonio Armistead, he gets to start this week at the cornerback position.
At the 6:20 mark, that's a big turnover.
Yeah. Well, you said, in the heat of the moment, we probably should have knocked that down, thinking of where the field position was going to be. Grove City Christian doing well tonight. They're traveling down the Miller Point. That's a heck of a drive down to Corning.
Hard to find D7. Well, they're D6, but hard to find small schools in Central Ohio. We enjoyed our trip down there for some small ball. Was that 2 weeks ago?
2 weeks ago. Fairfield Christian came out with a
17-14
walk-off field goal.
Yeah. Yeah. One wide receiver, a bunch of people in the backfield for Dom Bertha and crew. Trying to get him to jump offside. Chris, they've got Brian Robinson, actually a linebacker spot now, right in the middle of the field. He's going to blitz right up the middle. Ball goes right side to Nasir Phillips. Has a little room across the five. Forced out of bounds around the seven. It's on the far side. We'll check that spot. And still, it got more jawing after the play. I think Coach Jackson said, calm down. Talking with one of his players. I got that as number 10, I think. No, that's not Tyler. It is, I think it's Barry Wilson, Chris. Is that Barry Wilson?
Oh, yeah, Owen Barry Wilson in the, yes, the safety.
Indeed. So second and five after a five-yard gain out to the seven-yard line. Two wides, one split each way for Dom Bertha. I'm sorry, it is Dom Bertha. He'll keep it himself. Has a little room out to the 10-yard line before he's thrown to the turf unceremoniously.
Baker once again on the stop. Boy, I'll tell you what. We've right seen him 2 weeks in a row. That young man can play middle linebacker.
No doubt about it. Got a big old club on his left hand. Actually, all the way up to the elbow. Doesn't yeah. look like Chris?
Yeah, he's got a cast on there.
Third and two. South taking plenty of time. The play clocks have been off since the incident in the first half that I think sent Coach Jackson into tizzy, which, and I don't blame him. Three wide set on a third and two from the 10-yard line. Now a timeout's going to be taken by Coach Chris.
The South takes their first of the half. That'll leave them two, of course. Next week, we will are planning to be over at Hilliard Derby against Berlin.
Did you buy a 50-50 ticket?
No, I did not. I was.
So you're not going to get anything.
Four.
Look at that score right there, brother. 43-13 Lions.
One, five.
Of course, they got a running clock.
Two, one, zero,
your Lions
four,
finally
six.
Decided to show up.
One, five.
It could probably be in the 80s right now if they wanted it to be.
49-7 Gahanna.
Well, this would be a good time, and I'm sure Coach Ward's doing it, is getting those reserves a chance to back up quarterback sometime because
you have to.
You know, you just don't know when something's going to. And, you know, if fortunate is going to happen, or unfortunate is going to happen.
It's the nature of the game. Third and a big two here. South has been 2-3 and outs. They want to avoid the punt.
They need to move him here, Mitch.
Here's a quick pass. It's dropped by Wheeler again. Hit a defender on him. Lem Reynolds plays linebacker, and there's another three and out. Only take about a minute and a half off the clock, Chris. Coach Chris is not going to be real happy.
Westerville North has done a little bit better in the running situation here. They kind of bottled it up a little bit. Not that South was trying to flex that on them, but still.
The one run they haven't done is that little around the left side. That seems to be the preferred side and the stronger side of the offensive line. Kilmeyer is standing in his end zone to punt it away. Stevens and Solomon back.
And number three, Jonathan Stevens.
Snap back. Punts away. Actually, best punt of the night, a high kick. Stevens being driven back near midfield. Ball almost hits a South defender and trickles all the way down to the 38, 39-yard line. And Stevens just kind of saying, how can I make a catch when I got a guy falling down on my feet?
You could consider that.
Catch interference, could you? I would.
Kick, catch, interference. Easy for me to say, right?
Yeah.
That was Jude Kowalski out there on coverage, too.
I wonder why Jude isn't playing defense.
He's got that knee has got a heavy brace on it.
Does it? Where's old Jude at? He's a good player and got hurt the game we were here last year, right?
No, that was at North against Olentangy game. Yeah.
So Ronald Jackson and the North offense back out on the field again for another chance to cut it to one score lead. 5:06 remaining third quarter. I think they need to be a little bit more aggressive on first down here. Let's see if they might mix that up a bit. They can run the option left side, quick pitch. Around the left side at the 40, at the 45. Kicked out of bounds near the first down was Childress.
They've got a nice stable of steady running backs.
Yeah,
nobody over flashy, but they're all pretty decent.
I mean, nobody with a Coakley zip. The Coakley moxie. Actually, I was a pretty good running back. I was a little bit maybe possibly slow. I didn't have bad moves, but my straight line speed was, I told my Lions this year, I said, that ran about a 4 flat. Unfortunately, that was in the 30-yard dash. Second and two. Jackson hands off to Childress right side. At the midfield stripe. Ball's out on the ground. Scramble for it. I think North came up with it. That's going to remain North.
Coach Chris was awful enthusiastic there first, wasn't he?
He was jumping up and down. A lot of people, I don't know if you heard the background, everybody calling for a hold there. I didn't see the hold, did you, Chris?
No, I did not.
That's awfully close to a first down, but it's going to be third and about short.
Third down and one.
Third down and more like get the ball a length across the 49, you should have a first down. Well, this game's going to end at 10-ish. Ronald Jackson deep in the gun. And a handoff and tripping his way out to the midfield stripe. But if they mark him down where his knee went down,
that should be back another 2 yards.
They're going to get a very good spot. That should be enough for the first down.
He was down behind the line of scrimmage, Mitchell.
I'm not disagreeing with you.
Oh, they did move it back. They did
it back. Oh, my goodness. Wow. It sure looked like he tripped, but the referee came in and said, no, he was down back at the 48. That's going to be a loss of a half yard. And bring up an extremely important fourth and one. I'm not handing off. I'm giving Ronald Jackson a two-way, either run it or pitch it. Hard to believe they got a touchdown on their first drive and have not scored since then, Chris.
I don't think they've amassed much yardage either, to be honest with you.
No, they have not. They've had their chances. They've missed a couple shots. Fourth and one. Two tight ends, one wide left. Hand off to Stevens. Getting the outside, he has it. Dives for the first down. Boy, that's going to be awfully close.
Ball out.
They're going to say he's down.
Like, see,
the line judge on the far side pointing down.
He was marking it. You're correct, Mitchell.
I think that's, but they're going to have to measure.
Number 3, Jonathan Stevens with the carry.
Another Westerville North player down.
Well, South
injured.
Really defended that well. I thought Stevens was going to easily get that.
He looked like he had was going to be able to get the corner. So Reedy going to pick up another win, Mitchell. 37-0
over
Kip. That's late in the fourth quarter. Going to look at some local scores. These are all outliers. Watterson still 28-7 over Hartley at ODU. West Jeff put another one on Mechanicsburg, 27-17. Pick Central, no problem with the Wildcats of Newark, 41-10.
By the way, Chris, that was Stevens, who's the injured warrior, and he is.
Well, not only from the running back, but he's your starting strong safety.
He is really struggling to get out the field. Are those cramps?
It might be. He's not being, it looks like it's, he can't put pressure on any. Either leg.
Either leg. That's very unusual. Let's hope that young man's okay.
Boy, that Celtic Cardinal game over Thomas Worthy would be a doozy tonight.
Indeed. I
still
think
10.
First down,
by
the way, Chris. First down.
Okay, so they did move the chains. And the faithful here, you can hear folks loudly.
Not enthused with that call in the least. Or that spot, I should say.
Grove City starting to try to hang on the 9-point lead. 11-point lead, excuse me.
Over New Albany, 24-13. So first and 10, just shy of the midfield stripe. Still 21-7 here in the third quarter. So we're going to see more of Childress, I'm sure, a whole lot more of Reynolds. Stevens is okay. Looks really unusual walking
that
off.
That was not a pleasant sight to see.
Here's a throw on a slant route. It's caught at the 35 and holding on for dear life and saving a touchdown there. The pass is complete to Marion Walker.
Makes up for that drop he had earlier tonight. That was a nice ball delivered by Ronald Jackson right on the numbers.
Both these quarterbacks like that slant route. They feel confident.
I think they're most comfortable with that.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Reynolds and Childress in the backfield. Let's see if Stevens is able to make it back out. Odd to get cramps in both legs. Almost, maybe I wonder if he got a blow in the lower back or something. Telling a complete speculation there.
Or he's not hydrated.
Okay, Chris. Jackson to keep it himself. Hit at the line of scrimmage and taken down after a gain of about 2 yards from the 28 down to the 26. 2:30 left in the third, 21-7 South lead.
You look at Dylan Shoemaker, that outside linebacker at 5'10", 175. Basically a safety corner hybrid playing that outside linebacker.
They're playing it well. Gain of 2, 2nd and 8. Thanks for joining us on a beautiful Friday evening. Cooling off very nicely in the capital city of the great state of Ohio.
Panthers of Derby coming back on Maryville, 15-14 fourth quarter.
Two wides right, one wide left for Jackson. Straight back to pass. Quick throw right side, caught. Marion Walker with the grab. Check the spot here. It's going to be close to first down. I believe he's got it. They'll signal first down. Did you see who hung on to him to stop that touchdown?
No, I did not. I did not.
Nor did I. He was holding on that jersey for dear life. 17-yard line, first down and 10, Westerville North. What's that, St. Francis Sales score over St. Charles? 20-7 in the fourth? No. No, not at all. Clock on the move. Minute 33 left in the third. First and 10, 17-yard line. Quick throw on a slant route, and that's at the feet of the receiver, incomplete. Trying to get it to Walker again.
Cam Garcia on the defense.
Good
there.
Good coverage, too. Clock stops 125. Shamrocks 24-14 over on Tandy. Bradley pulling away from Arlington 24-10.
They might be the real deal. Out of the OCC Central.
Haven't seen them. Hard to say. I'm not saying they're not. I just haven't seen them. Over at the Marv. Wheelersburg hanging around with prep. Davidson on top of Orange, 14-10. Second and 10 here, 17-yard line. Three wide set again for Jackson. He has the snap, the run option left side. Pitches it to Childress at the 15, backing up, swarmed under, and
now
don't throw him down.
There it goes.
You just can't do it.
No.
They throw him down when the official clearly blew the whistle. What in the world? You just cannot do it. I had that as Childress, or was that Garcia doing that, Chris?
I'm not sure. I can't see the numbers on the far side there. They should have just let them go. The play was dead. You cannot take him to the turf.
You have three people there. They're blowing the whistle. You can boo all you want here on the home side, but that's just, you cannot do that.
No. Coach Chris will be the first one to tell you that.
Absolutely. He's not complaining.
No.
He's not complaining at all. So you take it from a third and would have been about a third and 14. That should be an automatic first down, right?
It is. It should be.
Let's just see where, because you can only mark half the distance, so.
It should be an automatic first down with a half the yard to the distance, if I remember correctly.
We'll see here, waiting for the call. Again, you can whine all you want here on the home side, but that was clearly a penalty.
So this makes it second down, so it's not an automatic first down.
Okay, it's going to be second and about three. We're at the 1:15 mark of the third quarter. Again, it's 21-7. Seven is the score.
So they're saying it's a spot foul, right? So it would not include an automatic first down.
Okay, so third and three. Jackson, again, the same three wide set. Keeps himself on the right side, cuts up, hit hard, and taken down short of the first down marker. The ball's out, and they're going to say it's down again. The referees are fine. They're not even entertaining it. You know, they're like,
no.
Come on. Your coach, Jackson, you've really struggled on these fourth down calls. What do you go with here?
You got to leave the ball in your son's hands here, honestly. You got to try to get him on the edge and try to make somebody miss.
By the way, Chris, I think I see Stevens walking around much more naturally now.
That's
on the
good.
Sideline.
That's good to see.
Fourth and three. Handoff left side to Childress. He's got the edge. He's got the first down, and he's thrown down around the three-yard line. That could be the last play of the quarter, depending on which coach Jackson wants to do. And it's Stevens coming back out on the field.
That's good to see.
No doubt about it. They'll wind the clock. Let's see. They're going to go right away, Chris. We're not going to wait.
Ballpark at the three-yard line, first down and goal.
One wide split to the right, and we've got a flag before the play.
I think it's going to be a legal shift or motion, one or the other.
Yeah, it's going to be a dead ball foul. Ronald Jackson pleading his case. The referee not even paying attention. And so you get first and goal from the four-ish, first and goal from the nine. That's a big difference. 19.3 seconds left. I see the marker back at eight. I would strongly suggest let this run down to the fourth quarter. Go down here, collect your thoughts, and get four plays in.
Well, maybe he's trying to think he needs all the time he can get and try to get it into the end zone before the quarter ends, Mitch.
Down to 13 seconds, yeah. Jackson hands off to Reynolds. He finds a hole inside the five, driving into the end zone for a touchdown. How about Lem Reynolds taking it in from 8 yards out? 3.2 seconds left in the quarter.
With a little assistance from Mr. Brian Robinson.
This is a one-score ball game. Please, there's one word I don't want to hear tonight, Chris.
And I know what that is, my friend.
That would be overtime.
Especially you have a long drive down to the Natty.
Actually, it's not that bad this time of night. There's just not a lot of people out.
Probably once you get south of Stringtown Road, you're probably okay, aren't you?
A lot of construction going on, as you well know, on 71. Link to attempt the PAT. And Coach Jackson's going to take a timeout. What do you think of going for two here?
Timeout, less than a goal.
Coach Jackson took his ball cap. I mean, did they have the right setup? Or there was something alignment-wise, because he took his hat off and put his hands in his face like, you know, we're wasting a timeout here.
You see, that takes it down to two timeouts remaining for both squads.
So this is a big score right here.
Of course it is. South's offense has been anemic here in half number two. I can't get any scores out of my hometown tonight on the Enquirer's website. That's really quite pathetic. What about use the hotspot on the phone? Does this thing not understand?
So Link here with the extra point.
It looks like they're still short a guy out there.
They do on the far side.
Yeah, on the left side. Snap, hold, and
blocked!
It's blocked. They didn't have enough people out there.
No, they did not.
So with 3.2 seconds left, the score means 21-13, which is, of course, massive, because now
you have to go for two.
A touchdown with a two-point conversion required to just tie it up.
We'll take a quick break. Come back here on CBUS Sports Radio.
Welcome to today's game. This is Paul Keels, and you know how much I love broadcasting the Buckeyes, but I also love high school sports. On behalf of the OHSAA, let's all do our part to set a good example and make this a fun and safe experience for the kids involved. I know this game means so much to the players, coaches, and fans, but high school sports are about much more than the wins and losses. They teach life lessons that will be with the players long after their playing days are over. Good luck to both teams, and remember to respect the game.
Certainly, Chris, we could not have been the only people that saw that they were short a guy on the left side. Was that just me?
I'm not sure, bud. I mean, it was quite obvious to me that.
Yeah. Lem Reynolds with a fantastic run, very powerful young man. Take it into the end zone, and then you unfortunately pooch the PAT. It's blocked.
Or did they have both wing guys on? Because it did look like they had double wings on this side.
It did on the right side of formation, no question about it.
Maybe that's where they thought the threat was coming from, Mitchell.
Well, the threat came, threat blocked, and it's an 8-point lead for South. That missed field goal's showing up bigger now, because you'd have, you know, 24-13 score, but here's the boot. Link puts it in the air, fielded around the 15-yard line. Bringing it near side of the 20, cutting back to the far side at the 30. Taken down around the 33, 34-yard line. And North a little bit extra pushing, but they did not take him to the ground. That's the end of the quarter, Chris. Let's take a timeout. It's 21-13, Wildcats lead. We'll come back with the start of the fourth quarter in a minute here on the CBUS Sports Radio Network.
Nothing refreshes the look of your home or business like new paint. Large job or small, business location or residential, Elshire Painting Plus, efficient and professional, hardworking and friendly. Call Scott for a color consultation at 614-302-6878 or visit them on the web at elshirepaintingplus.com for an estimate. Quality painting at affordable prices. Elshire Painting Plus, trusted inside and out.
You're listening to the CBUS Sports Radio High School Football Game of the Week.
Westerville South with a first and 10 from their own 31-yard line to start the fourth quarter, up 8. Final score, Olentangy Pioneers 17-14 winners over Davidson, Chris.
So Davidson drops two in a row after starting off 4-0.
Thanks to my buddy James Boggs for that score tonight. He's not happy as we have a flag on the handoff. Dear goodness.
I tell you, that's...
Did this crew get paid by the flag? Did you see anything there?
I was kind of looking at the system here, my friend, so I didn't get an opportunity to really look, but it does not surprise me that... I mean, that's got to be the 20th penalty at least, Mitch?
Goodness gracious. If they get paid by the penalty, they've got doggone Godfather's Pizza, which I used to really like, by the way. Hard to find it anymore.
I haven't heard that in a long time.
Hand off to Phillips' right side at the 25. Cuts back. Crosses a 30. Out of bounds around the 33, 34. They've got another injured player.
An injured?
Pretty physical ball game tonight.
Well, and they're going at it.
Yeah.
These two teams don't like each other.
Oh, they like each other, just not real well.
Well, and you're looking at it from the standpoint, whoever wins this game, whoever wins this.
Did you hear that, by the way?
What's that?
Pick North 16, Central 14.
Was the final?
I don't know if it's a final or not.
Let's see if I can find something on.
Winchester 31. Owen Sciota 7.
Canal all over Sciota. 31-7.
And that started off the other way. Remember, we were jumping.
Well, yeah, that was. Delaware, we should have known better.
31. Worthington Kilbourne, 0.
Kilbourne struggling, as you can hear in the background. Timeout as they attend to the player who's jogging off. That is
a fourth quarter score, Mitchell.
Okay. Boy, I tell you what, if the Werehawks come up with that win, that'd be massive. Barry Wilson went off the field, Chris. Gain of 7 on that play, by the way, makes it second.
I'll tell you
and
what,
eight.
The way Central's been playing, I think Gahanna's got them next week.
Can't take anybody for granted. Three wide set for Bertha. Hands off to Phillips. Crosses the 35, puts his head down and shoulder pads down and stretches out to the 39 to make it third and about 4. They're crowding the line of scrimmage so much right now, Chris. If he breaks the line, he's gone.
Ball's at the 39-yard line.
Third and a long 2, short 3, or short 2, long 3. Take your pick, whatever I'm trying to say. And off to Phillips again, near side. Breaks a tackle on the backfield, across the 40, out to the 44-yard line. That's the first down. He has an uncanny ability, like Jackson, honestly, to make that first man miss.
Yes.
We've got an injured player, and that is, believe it or not, Lem Reynolds.
Middle linebacker. Also, does a lot of running out of the backfield as well.
Scored that touchdown.
That looks like a cramp.
He's grabbing that right knee, and it is a cramp. They're stretching out that right calf.
Still seeing if there's any finals that have come in, Mitch. That way we can kind of wrap up a lot of halftime scores at the. Yeah, now we've got some finals.
Well, Darby comes back. How about that?
Darby comes back, wins 15-14. Olentangy falls to, Liberty. Shamrocks hold on at home 24-14. Red Raiders of London 36-6 over Bell Fountain. Pick Central 41-7 over Newark Catholic. Taze Valley with a big win over Circleville 45-7. East Knox 28-0 over Mount Gilead. Utica hangs on and beats Newark Catholic at home to go to 6-0 for the first time for the Redskins.
Lem Reynolds hopping off the field on 1 foot.
Sheridan 62-0 over the Black Bears of River.
Man. Slapped down by Sheridan. General's a good football team. We saw them in week 2 at Watkins Memorial. First and 10, the 1 o'clock with 11:25 left in the ball game. There it goes. They'll run it again, I would think, to the near side here. That's been their mojo. They'll go far side this time. Nasir Phillips being chased down by Robinson and others. Not much gain on the play, maybe a yard.
Yeah, Robinson with the stop there. Well, he just goes down that line and just jumps on people.
He does.
He's like a big bear.
Run down by a host of Warriors.
Give him just one-yard gain.
45-yard line, second down and 9.
Again, South learning to, looking to burn some clock up by 8. Three wides to the right side for Dom Bertha. The quick snap, or quick clap, looks over the sideline, gets to play. Hands off to Phillips right up the middle, has a little room, bounces left, crosses the 15 down to about the 49-yard line. Brings up another important 3rd and 3.
Sam Phillips on the carry.
Lots of Warriors coming off the bottom of that pile. Goble out there, I think, Chris, for Owen Berry. Owen Berry Wilson has not been back in since he got injured.
No.
Here he is right near side. I was wrong there. There he is right there, safety. Jonathan Stevens not playing defense now. 3rd and 3 for the Cats. A lot of people stacked in the middle of the defensive line, right over the tackles to tackle to tackle. See if they try to attack the edge. Back to passes. Bertha steps up, has time, throws it down the near sideline for Kilmeyer. He can't make the grab, in and out of his hands. Had a chance, but this is a defense. That was Barry Wilson who got back there, kind of knocked it out of his hands.
So Coach Chris rolling the dice, trying to pick up the first down there.
4th down, they'll punt. They're up by 8, 9:44 left in the game.
You were talking earlier about that back-to-back missed field goals there towards the end of the half. And, boy, that does loom large now. That make it a 2-score game, right?
Oh, yeah, easy. And you hate to say it, but it was bad snaps. High snap on the first one and a low snap on the second one. Kilmeyer back into punt, standing back at his own 35. High snap, but can't get over that young man's head. Low punt down the far side, hit at the 20, down to the 10, at the 5, and into the end zone. Funny, the South defenders weren't even looking to try to get back there and tag it, it down.
I think the gunner just kind of gave up on it. He thought it was going to kick into the end zone. It kind of slowly rolled, didn't it, Mitchell?
Indeed. First and 10 North from their own 20. Reedy's going to win big over Kitt, by the way. Not a surprise there. Columbus Academy going to...
6-0. Yeah. Coach Robin Miller, man, he's got him playing well.
Playing very well.
Congratulations to the Vikings. Used to cover them quite a bit years ago.
Indeed.
I think I've kind of figured this camera stuff out, Mitch.
Well, I'm glad, because I know it
irritates
you, frustrates you when you can't get it to work right.
One of our listeners not a fan of the game tonight.
Who's that, your mom?
It's kind of boring. I'm like, oh, this is a good game.
Sorry about that, Mom. We're doing our best. Warriors trying to get that tying score, but we'll see how much that PAT costs them, because they'll have to go for two.
Boy, tripped clear out to the right, Mitch.
Normally this is a screen pass. That's what it's been in other times. Fake the screen pass, Jackson to run himself. Burrows ahead for about 3 yards out to the 23.
Well, we've seen it.
Yes.
At any time that young man has the ball in his hands, he can
dangerous.
Take it to the house.
Yes, sir. Second and 7. Ball just shy of the 23. Long 7, if you like. Two wides right. I think that's Stevens to Jackson's left, Chris, in the shotgun. Jackson drops his mouthpiece, grabs it and puts it back in and waits the snap. Has it, going to run the option to his left. Hit and take
wow.
it down hard.
Ball's
out, and Stevens with a big recovery. I'm sorry, it was Childress with that recovery.
Childress there. He got there just before Cam Garcia did from his quarterback, his corner back position. And Ronald Jackson took a wallop there.
But they've hit him hard tonight.
I think it was Dave Furman that was able to get a piece of him.
Third and an important 7 to pick up for the Warriors, down by 8.
Well, actually, now they do have Vicroy playing the anchor on the short side, Mitch.
Did they flip
Zerman? Furman?
Yeah, Zay Furman to the other side. Looks like they did. He's on the left side of the defensive formation on this big 3rd and 7 from the North 23. Three wide set for Ronald Jackson. Back to pass. Looking to his right. Has plenty of time. Throws down the right sideline. Solomon makes the catch out near midfield. He got behind the defenders. That's happened way too many times tonight.
Yeah, without a doubt.
That was probably his best throw tonight, would you say?
Without a doubt. He put that right on a rope. Put it right where he needed to put it.
Great job. No pressure, and he just stood right in there and threw it down the far sideline and picked up yardage out to the 27. I'm sorry, the 47. That'd be a 20-yard gain. Actually, 25. The ball's at the 23. Well done, North. Wides each way for Jackson. He'll run the option right side, hitting the backfield again and able to. Well, they say forward progress to stop for a 2-yard loss, so he's going to lose a couple, even though he ended up near the line of scrimmage.
Couldn't see who made the stop, waiting for the call from the PA announcer.
You know, you threaten to bring binoculars all the time.
Two on the play. Second down and 12.
I'm just saying.
Well, actually, now they flipped it back around. Yeah, no, I believe it was Vicroy on the stop, 52. Because they did move Furman to the open side of the field, yeah.
That's okay.
If I can eliminate some of this equipment, I could probably bring a pair of binoculars for us.
7:22 left in the ball game. Four wides, twins each way for Ronald Jackson. Back to his left, brings a man in motion from the right slot. High snap, looking left, has time, under pressure now. Gonna run back to his right. Everybody surrounding him. He's hitting the backfield, and he'll be taken down back at the 37. Several defenders there, including Ian Smith and others.
He's done a good job from that Leo linebacker spot tonight, Mitch.
He has.
The ball to the 37-yard line.
Third and a bunch.
Third and about what, 20?
Yeah, looks like it.
Three wides right, one wide left. Everybody looking at the wristbands for the North offense at the 6:30 mark of the ball game. They trail by 8. Jackson puts Childress in the slot left side, so Twins left, Trips right. Need to gain 20 all the way down to the 43. Pressure coming, standing in the pocket and throwing across the middle, and hit and taken down immediately at the south 46-yard line. That was Will Solomon. So fourth and about, that was another good throw on that deep in route by Ronald Jackson.
Isaac Patterson on the stop for the Wildcats.
Big fourth down to say the least. Fourth and three-ish, maybe just over three.
They've got to convert here. 5:52 left.
They're going to go to that same formation. Trips right, Twins left. See if they go that deep in route again. Jackson looks at his wristband. Looks like just a three-man rush. Back to pass. There's a three-man rush, but a flag is thrown. False start against North. Did a wide receiver leave early, Chris? Yeah. I did not see it.
Anthony Gordon, I believe, the split end on this side, took a step. He's pleading his case with the back judge, and it's not going to go anywhere.
No, it's not. Coach Chris might have been given some encouragement there at the 5:35 mark.
Without a doubt.
So that makes it 4th and 8 now. Ball at the 49 of North. They need the 43 of South. We'll go Trips left this time, Twins right. Left is the short side of the field. Two wides right. Big cushion on that right side, Chris.
Timeout, Coach Chris.
So 5:20 left, he'll take a timeout. 21-13, his troops lead. We've only had, was all of our scoring, how many second quarter scoring do we have? Was most of it in the first, and I know we got a little bit sloppy there in the second.
Three scores in the second quarter, yeah.
But that was...
No, two. Two in each quarter. Okay. One was a missed field,
field goal
attempt.
Gotcha. Yeah. I got you. Okay.
Oh. Well, getting an alert from down in Texas. Let's see what's going on. Okay, they got the baby's room done. I thought it was that time for the baby, and it's not.
Chris about to be a grandpa for the second time. What's the young... Selassie, right? It's a girl? Or is it a boy?
Atlee. And my oldest granddaughter, Emma Bug. Emily, but I call her Bugger. So.
Imagine that, Grandpa. Imagine that. 5:20 left in this ball game. Wildcat Stadium, Westerville South High School. Mitchell Peak, Chris Coakley. 4th and 8. Ronald Jackson has three wides to his right side, one wide left. I believe that is Lem Reynolds to his left in the backfield. Might be Childress, I can't really see. The referee is, what are we holding things up for? Coach Chris saying something to somebody.
One of the sideline reporters, cameramen? They're not in the field of play, I'm not sure.
I'm not sure what's going on.
Well, he's talking to, that is the athletic director down on the field. That is Mr. Jeff Good, who is talking to somebody. They're talking about the clock or something?
Could be. I'm not sure who they're talking to.
Yeah, they're talking to the PA announcer right now. Pretty nice guy. That young
yes.
He comes over and
came here. We chatted with him before the game. And
Mr. Bannister was in here for up here for years doing the PA announcing.
I got to be resetting the clock, but it has not been reset yet. Still 5:20.
Okay, we're ready to go. Line.
All right. Again, three wides right, one wide left. Ronald Jackson in the gun, has the snap, back to pass, goes left side. It is caught, then dropped. In and out of the hands of the wide receiver on that side. We have seen that far too much tonight, both sides, Chris.
It was going to be a close play. It was going to be a close spot anyway, right, where he was?
It was. I think if he'd have made the catch cleanly, that was Anthony Gordon. But Jackson put it right on his hands again. Got to pull that in. 1st and 10 South at the 49, 5:15, so plenty of time left for North. They have two timeouts left. They need another defensive stop. They played well in the second half.
Get a three and out here.
Might end up with a long field, but all you want is a chance.
The South defense has played very well compared to what we saw them on September 1st.
Much, much, much better. Nasir Phillips to the left of Bertha. He'll get the carry right side at the 45. Spins out of a tackle down to the 44 is all. Gain of about 4 or 5 on the play.
Brought down by number 5, Javier Matthews.
Boy, I still wish we had they still had access to digital scouts. We could get in-game stats and see where Nasir is at rushing in today's contest.
My spidey sense tells me he's going to break one.
I've got a feeling you too. I mean,
not that that's a bold statement. He's a very good running back.
Concession stand. Lenita Ward.
Second and 6. Ball at the 45. They need to get to the 39.
Ball.
Don Bertha fumbles the ball and has a dive on it back at the 49. Fake the handoff. Was going to run the quarterback read to the left and jumps on it. At the 4:25 mark, clock will continue to run.
Ball's marked at the 49-yard line, third down and 10.
Let me complain again that the clock went from 4:21 to 4:14. As a coach, how am I supposed to know what to do? Three wides to the left, one wide right. Bertha, at the third and 10 from his 49-yard line to north. Pressure coming quickly, sets up a screen to Phillips. Has it at the midfield stripe at the 45, at the 40. And he's going to keep spinning, twisting, down close to the first down.
He got it.
He did. Great individual effort from Nasir Phillips. They haven't signaled it yet. I think they may have to measure, Chris. He was more towards the 38, and then he came back to the 39. That's going to be.
That's close.
Man, that is not a favorable spot. That's going to be awfully,
yes,
awfully close. I think it's going to be short.
I thought he had it with these, but you're.
The most unpopular men tonight. Umps. The umps.
The referees.
The officials. Oh, man. 3:49 left in the ballgame as they bring the chains out from the north sideline. If they do get a first down, you have to start taking some TOs,
yes,
I think, at some point.
I agree.
Pretty quick.
I agree, Mitchell.
Stretch of the chain, and it is short
about
6 inches.
Yeah.
Coach Chris, I would be floored if he doesn't go. Patterson's going to come in, then come back out. Again, the popularity not oozing towards the officiating crew after that spot. They're going to go just two wides, Wheeler and Patterson. Wheeler left, Patterson right. Two wings. They'll bring Kilmeyer on the right side. See if this is a quarterback keeper. And we've got an illegal motion against, I believe that was Wheeler. Or Patterson, I can't tell.
Full start against the Wildcats.
Now you got to boot it, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Fourth and 5. Man, you cannot give them this good a field position.
Yeah, we're going to kick it.
I think the prudent, the conservative call at the 3:43 mark. The clock will rewind.
Milk it for everything you can get here, too.
You know what? Why not
I
just
take delay
and take the timeout?
That or take the delay. I mean, you're only giving up 5 yards on the kick.
The ball's at the 44, so they could do that. Two safeties back. Stevens not back there now, Chris. Solomon is, but I don't see Stevens. No play clock to see. There's a snap back. Kilmeyer gets it away, punts it left side, hits it to 15 at the 10, and rolls into the end zone for a touchback. First and 10 from the 20 at the 3:12 mark. 80 yards to go. 3:09 is apparently we had to count a couple seconds extra. 8-point lead for South.
We've been very fortunate. We've had good games almost every week.
Yes, we have. That's the meme Nella sent me. It's a guy with yellow flags just throwing flag after flag after flag. Oh, boy, is that true. We do always have two loyal listeners. One from Chris's family and one from mine.
We're actually doing pretty well tonight. Thanks for tuning in.
We appreciate it. That's been a pretty entertaining game, to say the least.
Guys can always go back and watch the replay, or listen to the audio replay, or watch the replay on Twitch or YouTube or off of our website. It'll be at all three places.
Three wides for Ronald Jackson. Lone setback, I believe, is Childress. Kind of hard to tell. Chris said those numbers are really difficult to see. Lem Reynolds is going to come out and join the party. I have no idea where the play clock's at as he finally runs out there. He'll set up just to the right of Ronald Jackson. Takes the handoff to Childress, has time. Hit and dump back at the 10. Loses the ball. Does North come up with it?
Yep.
There's a signal. Westerville South, rather, comes up with it. They have it at the 10-yard line. Boy, he got drilled.
Who played with
it? I'm not sure. Zay Furman with the recovery, but I don't know if he made the hit.
Well, whoever made the hit planted Mr. Ronald Jackson.
On the proverbial backside, what a hit. Big play, South with a chance to put this one in the win column. Well, come close to putting it to the win column. First and goal at the 10. I tell Don Bertha, don't score. Let's burn some clock, make him burn timeouts. Bertha with Phillips to his right. The referee gives a signal, okay to play. Phillips with the carry right up the middle. Turns down to about the 5. Gain of 5 on the play. See if Coach Jackson takes his first time out. He does not. As you can imagine, South just letting that clock tick, 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 tick. Any other final scores of interest here, Chris?
Trying to find some, but they're Cannon Lincoln 49-7 over Westland.
Timeout's going to be taken.
Bradley 24-22 over Arlington.
Wow,
final.
Unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, Chris.
Against?
I think they're going to say it was against the bench.
Another
half
final.
The distance of the goal. Go ahead, sir. Bears 27-20 over Braves. How about that?
I'm in a conundrum.
No, you're not. Just do what the game you think is going to be best. Bradley 24-22 over Arlington. Jags appear to be the real deal, Chris.
Yeah.
Prep 32-16 over. Will,
that, they'll get points out of that as well.
Of course. As a dreaded overrated chance break out on the near sideline. They have something that South doesn't have, though. 5 wins. And good wins, too. They played a good schedule. So second and goal. I don't know why that's not an automatic first down in that situation. Everybody bunched in tight. Hand off to Phillips. Thrown down in the backfield for no gain on play. Stanley Jackson to take that timeout. At the 2:10 mark. A field goal does really make it difficult.
Yeah, yeah.
He's got one timeout left on a third and goal from about the 4 now.
So with Delaware picking up a win this week.
Yes, I know. Westerville South picking up a win to make them 4-2. I know what you're thinking.
But you have a good matchup. Darby at 4-2.
Yeah.
And Berlin at 5-1.
I know. It's your call. I can't commit to being. Oh, how about that, Chris? Thomas Worthington in overtime takes down the Celtics.
That might be the 4th loss for Jerome.
Jerome will take us. Would you just, how many times do I have to tell you to put my daggone hotspot on? Getting really irritated with this computer. Jeez. Man, what a big win for Thomas Worthington.
That is. They're 5-1.
I know. That's surprising. And Kilbourne is, man, just struggling.
Yes.
Second and goal. One timeout left North. South had wides each way. Phillips to the right of Don Bertha now moves over to the left. Everybody looking at the sideline as Phillips switches to the right again. Are they going to take a be close to delay a game here where the clock's not running? Don Bertha will keep it himself at the 10. At the 5, diving for the goal line, and he is
out at the 1.
Of all things to do.
Stop the clock.
Do not dive out of bounds stopping the clock.
Run down at the 1-yard line. Bring it up 4th down and goal.
Fourth and inches. Man. Coach Chris with the decision. He's going to bring in this defensive tackle. Zay Furman.
Eunice Osman Mohammed, please report to the press box.
They're going
to
go for it, Chris. Fourth and goal from about the 6-inch line. Tom Bertha. Hands off to Phillips.
He didn't get
it. I don't
in.
Think it came close, Chris.
No.
He did not.
So good attempt there by Nasir. Good stop by the Warrior defensive front line. I would almost take the field goal there.
I would have taken the field. Wouldn't have been any question. You're up two scores with a minute 59.
So now this gives them the opportunity, and with Ronald Jackson, ability to escape, ability to be able to run, he could take it to the house in two-point conversion. We're going to be here for another 45 minutes.
No. I rebuke you.
Man.
It's kind of an acute angle there. You're on the right hash. I get that, but couple things there is you cannot go out of bounds on third down. You can't
no.
do it. You don't need to score. You need time to go off the clock. First and 10, the ball's on the one-yard line. Jackson in the end zone. I believe that's Childress to his right. Four wide set. He's going to run it right side. Now he'll throw it right. And hit and exploded. And they had the ball knocked out of his hands. They're going to call that a personal foul? What was that? Did that not look like a clean hit to you?
To be honest with you, I was looking at the camera as I was trying to adjust it. I did not see. Did he launch at him? Did you see any with a launching of the helmet?
He hit him with his shoulder. I thought.
Defenseless receiver?
He's made a catch.
I'm just playing devil's advocate, my friend.
He knocks the ball out. Isn't that what you're trying to do?
Against the Wildcats.
You take it from the one that is 16 on a poor penalty. God bless. The amount of flags we've had tonight has been
unusually high.
At 9:48,
both Watterson and DeSales come out. We're gonna give these scores now, Mitch, because this is you got to get to the Natty, and at this rate, you're not gonna get leaving here till 10:30.
We don't have a tie ball game, which is, you know, it's doable. I mean, and what is the referee doing stepping in? I mean, seriously, what's the deal here? So I don't usually get this agitated, but good guy, we're trying to play football. What are we doing?
He's asking how many timeouts, I think.
Coach Chris is understandably upset at that call. His DB makes a fantastic play, and he gets rewarded with a 15-yard penalty. Jackson with the play-action fake. Goes down the hash. Over the head of the receiver. Incomplete. Trying to get the ball to Walker. Out around the 40-yard line.
I'll tell you, the defensive backs for Westerville South have played very well tonight. Now, there's been a lot of drop balls from the standpoint.
Wheeler dropped I thought it was a pick six there late in the first half.
Yeah, yeah.
Could have been a pick
but
six.
I mean, I'm talking coverage-wise.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Coverage-wise. They've done very well tonight.
Took 3 or 4 seconds off the clock, 1:48-ish left. One timeout remaining for North. Jackson again back to pass. Throws near side, and that'll be out of bounds. Incomplete. Trying again to get it to Walker. They make it 3rd and 10.
Intended for number 32.
Coach Jackson lobbing for more laundry, by the way. Go ahead.
That was Childress on the attempt there, I believe.
Oh, was it? Okay.
Yeah. Kind of ran a wheel route out of the backfield.
Empty backfield set with two wides left, three wides right. They switch one of the slot backs on the right side. We've got Solomon who comes in. Will Solomon, a senior. Ships right, twins left for Ronald Jackson on a 3rd and 10 from the 16. Has a snap, four-man rush, steps up, throws on the run, and it's dropped again. That'd have been a first down. We've had a lot of passes dropped, and we've had a lot of flags dropped. 4th and 10, this is your ball game effectively here.
Wildcat Stadium, 4th down.
Ball's going to be on the near hash mark at the 16. They need to get across the 26 for the first. They've been mainly rushing for the guy that's been getting the great pressure, though, as Chris has talked about, has been Zay Furman, the 6'1", 230-pound senior. He's on the left side of this formation. Ian Smith, the Leo linebacker, on the right side. Jackson in a five-wide set. Has a snap, back to pass, throws right side, and it is incomplete. And that should about do it. Trying to get it to Walker once again. That'll be first down for South at the 16-yard line. One timeout only left for Westerville North. The only thing I don't like about tonight, Chris, is the unbelievable amount of baby powder I have to smell as we break down tonight.
I've got to go home. I mean, you can see it all over my electrical equipment. I might have to contact OSHA. I'm just teasing, of course. I don't want to take away the fun that the students are having, but.
Westerville North fans starting to matriculate to the parking lots, especially the students. Hand off to Phillips left, 15 at the 10. Flag coming in, just for the heck of it. let's throw another flag.
Going to be a holding call.
Dear.
Holding against the Wildcats.
There cannot possibly have been as many holding calls as we had tonight. Is there anybody who's tracked penalties? I want to know how many have been thrown. I'm thinking 30 easily.
At least. I think you might start doing. We just start
making
notching,
yes.
Notching them on the spotting boards. And it's not an easy job, and we're not saying that's not what we're saying. It's just a lot of penalties tonight.
Yeah. Minute 26 left in the ball game. First and 20, back at the 26. I would just take a knee. Honestly, you can't.
I agree.
Phillips right up the middle. Inside the 25, down to about the 24, and Ronald Jackson. Stanley Jackson takes his final timeout.
Tackled by number 15, Alex Troyer. Timeout, Westerville North. Their final timeout of the half.
This should about do it.
Attention,
take a couple knees, and that'll be it, right?
Yasmin Mohammed, please report to the press box.
Any updates we want to get on finals at Catcher Eye there, C-Dog?
Still a lot of some halftime scores out there. Some big games tonight. I mean, some big wins for some teams at Berlin. Moving on, they knock off previous undefeated Olin Tangi. Liberty played tough, dropped to 10. I mean, you look at them. They've got one win. Are they? Go ahead. Can you pull up and see what they've got? I'll go to Joe Eitel for me real quick.
For Liberty, you mean?
Yeah, I think. Are they still winless?
Give me a second to get back to their region two, right?
Yeah.
Second down and 17.
1-5.
You know, they're in the playoff spot, right? I wouldn't want to play them right now.
No.
You know?
Look at Westerville Central as well in Region 2 or Region 3. Yeah, we're back to action here, Mitch. I'm sorry.
That's right. Should be a
deal
research.
Here.
I'm actually going to hand it off to Phillips. Just stay in bounds. He's going to get to the 20. And inexplicably goes out of bounds. I mean, why are you just taking a knee?
Well, trying to get extra yards, you never know. Maybe they're trying. I'm just saying, maybe they're, you know, trying to help his.
Or you can take a knee. You're going to have to punt. If you don't get a first down, what are you going to do? You going to kick a field goal? I mean, it's just unbelievable. They've got no timeouts left.
And you have to think of the risk of injury as well.
Exactly. You got a minute 15 left in the game. And Phillips is going to run left again, and a flag comes in again.
Yeah, it's going to be a face mask or a hold. One or the other.
Probably a hold, if I had to guess. The clock stops with the penalty. This game should be over. I should be heading to Cincinnati.
They get
bailed out with the face mask.
But what I really hate to see here, and I mean, I see what Coach Chris is trying to do here, but from the risk of injury, I'd hate to see something happen to your star running back.
Take a knee. There's no reason to run anything.
But we're not coaches, so we're just giving our opinion here, and that's what he wants to do.
Coach Chris can listen. That guy's a jerk. He's never broadcasting again.
They're going to victory formation.
Actually, it's third down. Because it's only half the distance to the goal line, so it's not a first down. So.
Don't snap!
The wife's words of wisdom, dear God, can we drag this out a little longer? We're giving it a shot.
No, fantastic ball game, though. South played really well tonight.
Yeah, they earned the victory. Don't take my, and he takes the knee now, so that should wrap this puppy up. This is probably one of the longest games I've ever broadcast. Almost three full hours.
We'll be able to see here on the...
We've been on the air since, what, 6:40-ish?
3 hours and 19 minutes,
yeah.
In the broadcast.
I can talk. I you know.
Well, you have no problem talking,
Ducks,
my friend.
Quack, never dogs had. Bark, and Mitch talks.
But, yeah, it's been a long game.
Well, with this win, 10 seconds left in the ball game. South is going to move to 4-2. North going to drop to 5-1. Boy, the bevy of points.
Yes.
That South is going to pick up being an undefeated team is remarkable. And that will do it. We're at the triple zeros. Just want to wrap this one up from right here, Chris, or do you want to take a final timeout? It's up to you.
No, I mean, it's up to you. However you want to do this, we can.
Let's bow out. What do you think? Final score in this ball game. Again, OCC Capital Battle. Coach Chris, don't take my criticisms personally of what you're doing. I'm just a blathering broadcaster. Move to 4-2. Big win.
Actually, it's not the last play of the game.
Oh, what?
They called it a delay of game.
Oh, okay. Okay, I apologize. We have triple series on. This game will not end. I don't know how much time's on the clock.
And it's just snapping, Neil.
Okay, come on, man, seriously. Then we come in and we knock Don Bertha to the ground. Golly Moses. That was ill-advised.
Ladies and gentlemen, final score. And
finally, the game is over. I don't even know if I'd shake hands. Coach Jackson is telling his team right now.
Yep, yep.
And to his credit, right?
Yeah,
to his
without
credit.
A doubt.
His team's going to drop to 5-1. Still in a great position.
Without a doubt.
You know, no reason to get upset about this performance tonight. I'm sure both teams are going to go to the locker room tonight and look at how many opportunities both teams missed. Receivers dropping passes, my goodness.
You know, yeah, I mean, a lot of opportunities, a lot of penalties in this. Not a clean game, but I'll tell you what. Westerville South did what they had to do tonight to pick up the victory and move to 4-2 and put themselves in good position. And you look at their upcoming schedule, Mitch.
Hayes next week at home, and that can happen.
And Winchester. So they get one of those two games, hope maybe both. I mean, Canal-Winchester was stretched to the limit a little bit tonight with Dublin-Scioto, so you never know. You never know. So
you do not.
Good broadcast tonight. We appreciate you staying with us. Like I said, you can go to CBUSSportsRadio.com, listen to the audio replays. You can also go to our Twitch and YouTube channels and look at the video replays as well. Mitchell, go ahead and wrap us up, and I'll get us a commercial getting us out of here.
Well, thanks for joining us on a Friday night. Once again, final score, Westerville South improves to 4-2 with a 21-13 win over Westerville North, who falls to 5-1. For Chris Coakley and Mitch Polybagus, have a great weekend, everybody. Hope to be back with you 2 weeks from tonight on the CBUS Sports Radio Network, where we'll be at, is that our Harvest Prep and St. Vincent St. Mary ball game?
That is October 6th. That is
it
correct.
Is, yeah.
The game that you will definitely be back for,
yes,
sure. Next week, keep an eye on our website. We're not sure where we're going to be at this point.
Have a great weekend, everybody.
Nothing refreshes the look of your home or business like new paint. Large job or small, business location or residential, Elshire Painting Plus, efficient and professional, hardworking and friendly. Call Scott for a color consultation at 614-302-6878 or visit them on the web at elshirepaintingplus.com for an estimate. Quality painting at affordable prices. Elshire Painting Plus, trusted inside and out.
Ted's Classic Cuts Barbershop, a family barbershop conveniently located in Gahanna, 345 Granville Street, Suite B. Ted's Classic Cuts gladly accepts walk-ins and appointments. Shop hours are Tuesday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., and on Saturday, 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. So So visit Ted, John, or Debbie for all your hair care needs. Call 614-337-8833 for an appointment. Ted's Classic Cuts, your family barbershop.